Hello, I am the autist known as Vol, and today my goal is to show you how to bring forth the sound of mares and mare-inspired sounds into this world. This is the introduction video. We're going to start off by talking a little bit about who I am. Who gives a shit? Fuck that. So this video series is essentially supposed to act as a primer on music production. Essentially, it's supposed to give you a feel for what's out there. What this video series is not going to be is a comprehensive step-by-step music production tutorial. There are simply way too many skills and disciplines involved in music production for me to cover them in a reasonable amount of time. And there is no one procedure to make a song. Every producer has a unique approach to music production, and those approaches can even change over time. So I can't give you a step-by-step tutorial. What I can do is start you off with the basics, and highlight the common elements that are important in music production. Chances are, if you want to start off in music production, the first thing that you're going to need is a piece of software known as the Digital Audio Workstation, also known as the DAW or DAW. The DAW is a software environment that allows you to do things like recording and manipulating audio clips and MIDI clips. The DAW also acts as a host for plugins, which are virtual instruments and effects that you can use to create your music. On this slide, you will see a bunch of options for DAW software. Some of them are free, some of them are paid. For some of you, you don't care. Now, how do you select a DAW? The main thing that you need to consider as a beginner is mostly the features that the DAW actually has. For instance, the Audacity variants have little to no MIDI manipulation capabilities, which is fine if all you want to do is voiceover work. But you know, it's not fine if you want to do anything involving music. And I realize that a lot of people watching this might not actually know what MIDI is. In short, MIDI is the musical language for computers. It's how computers store, read, and communicate information about notes and beats. The point I was making was that if you want to make music, your DAW should be able to manipulate MIDI information. On the other hand, LMMS and the Fruity edition of FL Studio have no audio recording capabilities, which can be quite important if you want, you know, recorded guitar or vocals in your songs. Beyond the basic features, your decision as a beginner of which DAW to use is mostly arbitrary. Over time, as you work on music, you may develop preferences for certain workflows that may bias you towards selecting one DAW over another. But once you've selected your DAW, basically you've got to install it and you've got to learn how to use it from tutorials online. Every DAW works differently. Now, beyond the software environment, we have to talk about the actual process of music production. And the way that I've decided to do this is to split up music production into different elements. Who could have seen that coming? First, research. Research for getting ideas for your music and also to help develop your skills as a music producer. Listening. The skill of how to listen to your own productions and build your musical production skills by listening to others. Composition and arrangement, essentially deciding where the notes and the beats go. Recording, capturing sound from the real world to generate sound clips. And its brother, editing, slicing and dicing sound clips and adjusting basic parameters of those clips like timing, pitch, and speed. Writing, the process of writing lyrics. Mixing and mastering, controlling the aspects of our music that aren't directly musical, adjusting parameters like volume and pan and applying other effects. Sound design, selecting sounds for our tracks or creating new sounds through recording, sampling, synthesis, and effects. And lastly, working with technology, working with the tools of our trade, DAWs, plugins, and in our case, AI software like 15.ai and TalkNet. All of these different skills come together to create the unholy mass that is music production. This concludes the introduction segment. Now for the rest of the videos in this series, I plan to have individual videos explaining each element in more detail. I'm also going to have a demonstration video in which I'll try to demonstrate each of these elements while I make a song about Pi Day. I hope this video series can be of some use to you. If my voice sounds a little weird, it is because the plants have decided to reproduce yet again. And while the plants' bodies are telling me yes, my body is telling me no. But I will not allow allergies to get in the way of this series. I will not allow schoolwork to get in the way of this series. I will not allow active renovations to my living space to get in the way of this series. Welcome to research. Be warned, this is going to be a bit more philosophical and less concrete than the other sections. If you're not interested in listening to the philosophical stuff, I completely get it. Feel free to skip this part. Now, what do I mean when I use the word research? By research, I mean gathering information and ideas, particularly musical ideas, from both internal and external sources. We do research for two main reasons. The first is to find inspiration, to find new ideas that make our work interesting and hopefully impactful. And the second reason is to get good. Simply put, when trying to learn how to be a good music producer, it helps to know what good music production sounds like. And it can be quite productive to study good examples of music production. So here are some ways that you can research. One effective way to research is, quite simply, to experiment with making music. And experimentation is not so far off from shitposting. When you're making shitposts, there's no pressure to make anything good, which can sometimes lead you into creative possibilities that you wouldn't have considered if you were actively trying to make something good. When you're in the shitposting mindset, you want to try to avoid paralysis by overanalysis. However, strategically, you should also consider that if you never pay attention to quality at all, that can also harm your skill development. Another good source of inspiration is touching grass. As anonymous users of an online image board, we have extensive real-world experience from which we can draw. No, seriously. The nice part about the real world is that it doesn't give a shit what you think. It just does. The spontaneity, the unexpectedness, the uncontrollability of the real world can provide a much better source of fresh ideas than mulling over the same content over and over again on your computer screen or in your head. Sometimes your best ideas arrive when you're not even looking for them. Upon first appraisal, for many of you, this may not seem to be the case. You might think, my life is boring as hell and every day is exactly the same. Looking for inspiration from the real world can sometimes be difficult, but there are techniques to help. Another good way of finding new ideas is applying creative techniques that are regularly used by writers and songwriters. One example of this is the SCAMPR technique, standing for substitute, combine, adapt, modify, put to another use, eliminate, or reverse, which shows there's a bunch of ways we can manipulate an existing idea to try to create something new out of it. Another creative technique that I haven't used much yet, but seems to produce good results, is object writing. This is an exercise out of Writing Better Lyrics by Pat Pattison. Basically, what you do is you take a noun, an object or a concept. You set a 10-minute timer so you don't get brain fatigue, and then you do a sensory deep dive. Essentially, you look for events and real-world experiences that you associate with that object or concept. And when you're going through those experiences, you think about, where are you? What are the things that you're sensing, physically or emotionally? What sort of music does this make you think of? And you're writing all of this down over that 10-minute timer. Now, probably the most obvious method of research that I haven't mentioned yet is to consume, but spelled correctly, because unlike the average consumer, you are doing it mindfully. When you're listening to music, whenever you're watching a TV show or reading a book, ask the question, what kind of music does this make me think of? Essentially, if you're disciplined enough about it, you can turn consumption from a passive activity into an active activity where you're actively exercising your imagination. You don't just accept the work as it is presented to you on the screen or on whatever medium it's presented in. If you're watching a TV show, imagine yourself as that character. Put yourself in that environment. What do you see, feel, or do? One important thing to understand about consumption is that it actually helps you develop your taste. Over time, you can refine your feel for what are the things you like and what are the things that you don't like in the content that you consume. And as you get better at music production, you start figuring out how to make the things that you like. If you want to be excited about making music and be motivated to develop your own style, you have to figure out what appeals to you first. Oh yeah, and you can also read these things called nonfiction books, which can tell you how to do certain things involved in music production. Or sometimes you can read the autobiographies of your favorite artists to figure out the thinking behind their music. Now lastly, there's a technique that I call the listening journal, which I'm going to cover more in the listening section. Now all of this has been very abstract, so I thought it'd be helpful to show some examples of where I get the ideas for some of my music. After listening to a lot of Vaporwave, Synthwave, and Earth, Wind, and Fire, I jammed them all together in a bunch of prototypes. A lot of experimentation was done, which eventually led to the creation of the piece now known as Vapor Shy. Sleepless Moon Dancer is based on my real-life experiences with neighbors that are just too damn loud at night and an unresponsive apartment office that won't do anything about it. If you listen to this album, all I really have to say to you is that I live in a very blue state, and I was very peeved at the state of things. No further explanation is required. And for some more conventional inspiration, how about getting into some old school rap? A little bit of Public Enemy, a little bit of Ice Cube, leading to a great and powerful diss track. And yes, I do, in fact, watch the rewatch stream. And for some reason, seeing the commercial for Pinkie Pie's RC car compelled me to make a song about Pinkie Pie's RC car. Okay, so if you're wondering where all those techniques went, here's something a little bit more sophisticated. Now, at the time, I didn't explicitly intend to implement the scamper technique, but this fits within that framework. So, we know from watching the show that Rainbow Dash is a pony who says things that make other ponies uncomfortable. So if we sort of adapt elements from real-world politics, we could say, you know, maybe Rainbow Dash is the politically incorrect pony. She's like that one friend that everybody has that pushes a little bit too far in conversations and might come off as culturally insensitive, but not in a malicious way. She just has strong feelings. Which first led to the creation of Rainbow Dash Hates Pride Month. And for some reason, people seem to like that idea so much that I just kept on milking it. Stay on that grind set, kings. Welcome back. In accordance with my scheme of starting with the most boring topics first, let's talk about listening. Listening is a skill, even if it doesn't seem like it. And of course, the listening section follows the research section because listening is closely tied to research. We exercise our listening skills for two main purposes. Firstly, we need to use our listening skills to listen to our own music. This is to do things like basic error checking, checking for problems with intonation, rhythm, tone, if there are any bad noises in our song, or just making sure that all the important parts in our song are intelligible. And secondly, of course, we want to make sure that our song sounds good. We also need to use our listening skills when we're listening to other people's music. When you're listening to music as part of conducting research, you want to be able to distinguish what's actually going on so you can pick out the parts that you like and pick out the parts that you don't like and figure out how to emulate that in your own music production. There is also a technique specific to mixing called reference mixing, which actually we're not going to cover much here, but it does involve listening skills. Now let's go a little bit more in depth. Firstly, we gotta listen to our own productions to listen for things like problems with timing. Intonation. Unwanted artifacts, noises, and mistakes, such as that introduced by sloppy cutting, and mixing, which we are going to cover in more detail in the mixing section. Now, of course, when you're listening to your own music, you're not just going to be listening for those tiny, minuscule mistakes, most of which you have some leeway in dealing with. You also need to be worried about high-level stuff. You need to be asking questions like, is there anything that needs to be added or removed? Is there too much or too little going on? Is your song too boring or is it too busy? How does your song sound? Does it sound too muddy or harsh? Does it line up well with the story you're trying to convey? Can you make out the most important element? In many songs, the most important element is the vocals. Now, here are some tips for listening to your own productions. Firstly, here's something that I don't do enough, taking breaks. Prolonged listening to music, especially at high volumes, can really fuck up your hearing perception, and over time, it can even cause hearing loss. If you're feeling very irritated and fatigued while listening to your own music, it may be time to put the headphones down. Now, another technique that I find particularly helpful, especially when I'm looking for small errors, is listening to the song in different contexts. Listening to your song in different contexts can help you find mistakes, features, and ideas that you wouldn't have noticed listening on your normal sound system. It can also provide you with a better idea of how the sound of your track is going to translate across different listening systems. In order to listen in a different context, you can listen on a different sound system, such as using your smartphone or your car speakers or your laptop speakers, or you can literally listen to it from a different location. Different locations will have different kinds and levels of ambient noise, as well as spatial characteristics, all of which can color the way that you hear your productions. One popular mixing trick is actually to listen to your production from speakers down a hallway. Another more advanced listening tip is from time to time to listen to the production in mono instead of stereo or surround. And for those who don't know what that means, basically most digital audio is structured in stereo, having two different tracks of audio information, one for your left ear and one for your right ear. And when you listen on a stereo speaker system or a pair of headphones, the left ear channel gets played on the left speaker and the right ear channel gets played on the right speaker. This capability allows us to create the illusion of audio being played in a physical space. This capability is also heavily abused by ASMR videos. Having a noise heavily panned off to the left or right gives the impression of something being very close to one of your ears. When you listen in mono, however, there is only one track, and if you're listening to a mono track on a stereo system, then both speakers will play the same information. Now let's get back into why listening in mono from time to time is important. Why do this? One reason that you might want to listen in mono is because, well, firstly, some sound systems are just mono sound systems. You have one speaker, and that's it. But also, if music is being played on a stereo system from a certain distance away, it may end up effectively acting as a mono audio source. Also, certain issues that deal with translating the music between different sound systems can be more easily detectable in mono. If you have doubled vocal tracks, which are a method where you take two different vocal takes and you pan them off to either side of the mix to create a fatter vocal sound, issues with intonation and timing will be more audible in mono than in stereo. There are lots of physical and psychoacoustic reasons behind these things, which I won't go into here. Additionally, some producers swear by the method of adjusting panning in their tracks while listening in mono. If nothing else, you can look at mono as just another context in which you can listen to your song. Now, here are some tips in particular for people who are recording vocals or instrumental tracks. When checking your intonation, it may help to check against a tuned instrument, such as a synth, that essentially has perfect pitch. And obviously you can also check against a real world piano, which I don't have in the moment. Similarly, for vocalists, it can be helpful to check your intonation against an auto-tune version of your own vocals. And if your pitch is all over the place, an auto-tune will capture that.
Chin up, don't bet on sinking ships because you've got to be more grand. Chin up, don't bet on sinking ships because you've got to be more grand.
Even if you are a pitch correction purist and you believe that autotune is for losers, autotune can still be useful for you. In terms of rhythm, the best thing to do is probably to check against a click track or against a drum track. Of course, keep in mind that not everything has to be perfectly aligned to a click track. A lot of famous music was not even recorded to a metronome. Bands that didn't use metronomes on some of their biggest hits include Rush, Earth, Wind & Fire, and Creedence Clearwater Revival. If you try to align their tracks to a click track, it simply won't work. And even when a lot of artists do use click tracks, they don't play exactly on the beat. A lot of West Coast rappers and rap groups, think Cypress Hill or Snoop Dogg, actually make it part of their style to rap slightly behind the beat. Jay Dilla made a whole career out of not even being on the beat. Now let's talk about listening to other people's music. And again, as we mentioned in the research section, this is all about figuring out the things that you like and figuring out how to make the things that you like. Now we're going to talk about the listening journal. For beginners, what this is a method for mindfully listening to music. Essentially, you just need to take notes while you listen to music, or at least just think about the questions that are listed here. Try to identify what are the sounds that you're hearing, what are the instruments used, or how do they make that sound? What about the sound or the song appeals to you? What doesn't appeal to you? What do you want to avoid? What makes a song feel the way it does? What makes it sound unique or exciting or creative? These are all things that you can pick up in your listening journal and try to incorporate into your own music. And if you don't know the answer to any of these questions, you can always try to ask somebody. Here are some example notes I took on Tatsuro Yamashita's music. Your notes do not have to be this sophisticated. There's a lot of music theory involved in these notes, but this is sort of an example of what you can do when you're listening to music. Again, as a beginner, it is perfectly productive to just address the questions on the previous slide. Now, those of you who are more musically advanced can move into transcription rather than just taking broad notes about a song. Of course, this requires you to have a lot of familiarity with how to play your instrument. Transcription is essentially the act of copying music by ear and either writing it down or simply learning how to play it. This is one of the primary techniques used by jazz musicians for developing their musical skill. In our case, combining transcription with a little bit of musical theory can provide a lot of insight on understanding other people's music, and particularly when playing transcriptions, it also helps us internalize their style into our musical vocabulary. You can choose to transcribe segments as long or as short as you want, from an entire song down to a single riff or even a single figure within a solo, and you can transcribe at many different levels of detail. You can start by simply copying the chord progression of a song or the bass line, which is just single notes, and if you get really, really good at transcription, you can do note-by-note transcriptions of entire songs. If you need resources to check against, of course, you can always check against the actual sheet music for the song, or against online lessons or tutorials that teach instrumentalists how to play that song. But of course, reading off sheet music or listening to a tutorial won't help us develop our listening skills as much. If you're really looking to seriously challenge both your production and your listening skills, you can make a cover song by ear, like I did for That's Life. In the listening section, I might as well address the hardware that we use to listen to music, namely headphones and monitors. Now take the following section with a grain of salt. This is mostly what I got from stuff online. I'm not an expert in hardware. I've used the same headphones for around 6 years, and aside from my phone speakers and a pair of wireless earphones, these headphones are pretty much the only thing I use to listen to my music. And if they're good enough for Snoop to wear for 5 minutes, they're good enough for me. Studio headphones, also known in the producing world as cans. Unlike consumer headphones, studio headphones are not necessarily meant to provide the best listening experience, but they are meant to provide you with a neutral, high-fidelity sound that can be used to mix a song that will be heard on many different sound systems. The main things that you're looking at when selecting headphones are comfort, build quality, and frequency response. As with any consumer hardware, quality increases with price, but you get diminishing returns. The baseline thing for comfort is that you want to make sure that the headphones you buy fit your head, firstly, and then all the ergonomic stuff that I don't understand follows. Now, when I talk about frequency response, I am mainly advising you to avoid really cheap headphones which can't accurately reproduce low or high end, or, you know, heavily marketed consumer headphones like Beats headphones, which tend to boost bass frequencies. Boosting bass frequencies can be great for your listening experience, but not so great if you want to mix a neutral sound that can be reproduced well across many different sound systems that aren't your headphones. Now, in addition to these factors, there are two main types of headphones. There are open-back headphones and closed-back headphones. Closed-back headphones tend to be more durable, and they will have less bleed in recordings, meaning that if you're playing a sound through your headphones, it is more easy for a mic to accidentally pick up a sound played through open-back headphones rather than closed-back headphones. This is mainly relevant in vocal recordings, where you're using headphones to listen to the music while recording your singing. This also means that closed-back headphones will allow in less noise from the external environment, such as the one going on behind me right now. On the other hand, being closed, closed-back headphones have the potential to introduce unwanted resonances into the audio that you're listening to, whereas open-back headphones will have more fidelity by being less resonant. Another factor to consider is whether the headphones cables are detachable, which can be important if you are the kind of person who breaks cables by sitting on them with your chair. Another thing to consider is the range of motion for the headphone cups. Of course, range of motion has implications for comfort, but this can also be important in vocal recordings, and I'll explain this in more detail in the recording section, but essentially there are times where you might want to consider having one ear off the headphones. And if your headphones are completely rigid, you can't really do that without risking breaking your headphones. In general, if you stick to headphones called studio headphones and stay away from the consumer stuff like Beats or AirPods, you should be fine. Lastly, a very brief note about monitors. Monitors are things that professional music producers use. Essentially, they are speakers with the same intent as studio headphones to provide you with a neutral sound that's great for mixing. I don't use monitors because... Just like that! You know, that might cause some problems with the neighbors. The reason that music producers use monitors instead of just doing everything through headphones is that headphones do not accurately reflect many of the ways that most people listen to music. For instance, car speakers or home sound systems. But again, I've never used them, so I'm really not in any position to give advice about them. It is 7 a.m. on a Monday, and therefore it is time to briefly talk about composition and arrangement. The terms composition and arrangement are often used interchangeably. Practically, composition is simply deciding where the notes go and on which instruments. I consider composition to have two main parts, the how and the why. The how of composition is music theory, understanding keys and chord progressions, developing melodies and harmonies that work within those keys and chord progressions, developing rhythm and beats within tempos and time signatures, deciding on instrumentation, that is, what notes go on which instruments, as well as more high-level strategic stuff, like deciding what structure your song should have or what sections it should have. For example, verses, choruses, refrains, bridges, solos, as well as classical forms such as the sonata. And yet, this is not a music theory course. As a matter of fact, I am not formally educated in music. Everything that I know is haphazardly assembled from little bits and pieces of knowledge I pick up, and I really don't think I have the systematic grounding to give you a good introduction to music theory. So if you want to learn about music theory, you're going to have to consult other learning resources. Okay, so music theory is the how of composition. The why of composition mainly for me involves thinking about composition as musical storytelling. No different than when you're writing a fictional story, you think about things like tension and release, controlling the energy levels in the story, building and subverting or fulfilling expectations, making sure to keep things interesting for the reader or the listener throughout, and making sure that the most important elements, plot points, or in this case, instruments, such as the vocals, are intelligible. In particular, repetition is a very important element in musical storytelling. Most often, repetition can create expectations which can then be subverted or fulfilled. But it's easier to understand this stuff when you're looking at an example. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to look at the solo section of my cover of Sinking Ships. And instead of having me talk over the song, we're going to have text on the screen explaining some of my compositional choices. Next, let's take a look at Ivermectin off the A Safe and Effective Heartswarming album. This example in particular is to help you understand all the different instruments that go into a particular part. We'll be right back. Okay, I know there wasn't a lot of information here, and basically that's because I don't feel like I can adequately cover composition in this series. In my view, in order to get good at composition, you need two things. Firstly, you need the theoretical knowledge, so you can place things in key, or you can at least know when a note is in key or out of key. You also need musical vocabulary, and therefore you need to study a lot of different music using the techniques described in the listening and research sections. In particular, it's important for you to be able to identify chords when you hear them and figure out how they feel. Figure out how certain keys or key modulations and chord progressions feel. Figuring out how certain rhythms feel. Looking at the why of composition, you need to look at what are the clever things that the composer does, for example, to control tension and release, or to ensure that the most important parts of the instrumentation stand out. Why did the composer choose to put a sound in a particular place? There isn't always a good answer to these questions. Sometimes composers just put things in because they feel like it. But sometimes when asking these questions, you can notice something important. That concludes the composition and arrangement section. Remember, Ivor Merrickton is not just horse dewormer. Wow, it's finally time to get to one of the interesting parts. Recording is all about capturing sounds from the real world to generate sound clips that we can then use in our music. If you decide to be an electronic-only musician, you probably don't have to worry too much about this. In the actual process of music production, recording is closely tied to editing, which is why editing is the section that immediately follows this one. The main piece of advice in understanding recording is that, in general, good music starts with quality recordings. Not everything can be fixed in post. I view getting recordings as involving three factors, namely, instrumental technique, having a proper hardware setup, and having good mic setup and technique. Starting with instrumental technique. If you are recording instruments, there are some things that you can do that will alter the quality of your sound, which vary from instrument to instrument. For stringed instruments in general, you want to make sure that your instrument is in tune. Ideally, not only is your instrument in tune, but it should have good intonation. And what that means is that your instrument stays in tune up and down the keyboard or fretboard. No matter how high or how low you play, your notes should be in tune. And this can be a problem with cheaper instruments or instruments that are poorly set up. For electric guitars in particular and similar instruments, there are lots of different factors that you can play with that will affect your sound. Particularly, your tone and gain potentiometers will greatly affect the amount of electrical noise introduced into your sound. The higher your gain is set or the brighter your tone is set, the more noise you'll get. Also of importance is your pickup switch. Aside from simply affecting your tone, some Telecasters are wired to be hum canceling on the middle pickup position. Whether you're using single coil or humbucker pickups will affect the tone of your sound, as well as the presence of, obviously, hum. If your strings are dirty with finger grime, they can produce a dramatically different sound from strings that are clean. If your frets are worn down or if your guitar is otherwise improperly set up, you could get fret buzz. If your electrical contacts on your guitar are shoddy, they can introduce unwanted noise. On acoustic guitars in particular, you can get finger squeaking in your recording, which may or may not be something that's desirable. On the vocal side of things, again, there are a lot of things that you can do with your instrument, that is your voice, that will affect the quality of your recording. As you may or may not have heard from my voice from video to video, whether you have allergies, whether you've just woken up, whether you rest your voice insufficiently, or whether you've warmed up, are all critical factors in determining the tone of your voice at the time. In addition, there are a lot of noises that your mouth can produce that are detrimental to the quality of your recording. The first of which is sibilance. Sibilance is a harsh, high-frequency sound that is produced whenever we pronounce an S sound, which can become irritating over time if it is particularly obtrusive in your recordings. The next noise to discuss is pop. Pop is a low-frequency noise or distortion that occurs whenever we force a large amount of air out of our mouth at once, typically when we are producing P sounds. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. The main way to control pops during recording is by using a pop filter, which is a mesh screen that you place in front of your microphone to prevent it from capturing pops. You can also DIY this by placing a thick towel over the microphone. However, this does have the downside of slightly muffling your voice. Another technique used by artists to control pop is by altering their pronunciation of words by substituting the B sound for the P sound. Lastly, mouth clicking. If your mouth is too dry or too wet, or your tongue has a tendency to touch the other parts of your mouth a lot, you're going to hear a lot of unwanted clicking in the recording, coming from the sound of saliva popping. This is one reason it is important for vocal performers to drink water, unless they're lazy like me. Now, both while you're playing your instrument or while you're singing, and when you're listening to your recording afterwards, you need to develop the skill of listening to what you're playing to make sure that you're in tune and on beat, which is more difficult than it sounds. Where you should record against a click, a drum track, or a metronome to ensure that you're in time. Headphones can be helpful for preventing the neighbors from hearing your latest Pony Zone, but they also artificially color your hearing of everything outside your headphones, particularly if they're closed-back headphones. Combining this with the fact that there is latency in your audio chain, you get an issue with using headphones to listen to music while you're recording. Mainly, wearing headphones while recording can be detrimental to your intonation and rhythm. So a common trick for recording with headphones is to leave one ear off so you can still hear yourself or your instrument. And that's why it's important to get a set of headphones with which it's easy to do this. Personally, I like to have my headphones in front of my ears so I can still kind of hear the beat, but also hear my own voice. Other tricks that I use, but I'm not really sure if they work, include muting the drum track and only listening to melodic tracks while recording, which is supposed to help me stay in tune by helping me not get distracted by the drums. Another thing that I've tried to do is put on a reverb track while monitoring my own voice to kind of fake the singing in the bathroom effect. So those are all the things that you can do to help you get better recordings on the instrumental end. Now let's talk about hardware and hardware setup. First, the elephant in the room, the microphone. There are many microphones out there, each with their own upsides and downsides. A YouTube channel that seems to be pretty knowledgeable and trustworthy when it comes to reviewing different microphones is Podcastage, which I'll link in the slides here. That being said, for the sake of completeness, I'm also going to cover a little bit about microphones here. Microphones can firstly be categorized by their construction. There are condenser microphones, and there are dynamic microphones.
There's a great deal of debate online about the actual differences between condenser and dynamic microphones. Generally, condenser microphones are recognized to be more sensitive than dynamic microphones. That is, they can capture the high-frequency components of sound with greater fidelity than dynamics. They are also commonly stated to be more fragile than dynamic microphones. But really, this depends on the particular construction of the mic that you are using.
Sometimes lower sensitivity is in fact an advantage. For example, dynamic microphones are sometimes used in studios to capture vocals while the music is played out loud on speakers, and that helps you solve the caveat that we had with recording with headphones on. Microphones can also be categorized by their polar pattern, or directional sensitivity. The polar pattern of a microphone essentially characterizes how well the microphone can pick up sounds coming from various directions relative to the microphone. The most common polar patterns that you will see in microphone include the cardioid pattern, the figure eight pattern, the supercardioid pattern, the omnidirectional pattern, and you may also encounter multi-pattern microphones. Microphones with the cardioid polar pattern reject sound from the back, which can be desirable if you can control the noise in your environment to only come from one direction. Thus, microphones with cardioid polar patterns are the most common ones you'll find used by musicians and voice workers. Microphones with the figure 8 pattern reject sound coming from the sides. Supercardioid mics are like cardioid mics, but they accept sound from a narrower range of angles in the front, and also accept a small amount of sound from the rear. Omnidirectional mics accept sounds from all directions, which can be useful for recording ambiences, for example, the ambient sound of a city or a desert. They can also be useful as room mics for drum kits, essentially capturing the sound of the room as drums are being played to give the drums a bigger sense of space.
Lastly, multi-pattern microphones will offer multiple settings for selecting different polar patterns. If you're considering buying a microphone, here is a little bit of a buyer beware section to save you some time. You do need to care about cables and connectors. You care about what kind of cables microphones use. They might use XLR cable, 3.5mm or 6.35mm TS or TRS cable, or some microphones just use USB. Most computers will only out of the box accept 3.5mm or USB, so you'll need an adapter or an audio interface if you want to use any other kind of cable. In addition, some condenser microphones require something called 48 volts phantom power to amplify the signal in their internal electronic components. This will require the use of an external audio interface or a power supply. On the other hand, trying to run phantom power through a mic not designed to use it will most likely damage it. There are a whole bunch of other criteria that you can really dive into the rabbit hole on. Frequency response, impedance, SPL rating, or sound pressure level, which is the maximum intensity before distorting, and that's important for miking loud instruments like drums. Self-noise, signal-noise ratio. Many, many factors that you can consider. But I think I've spent enough time talking about microphones. Now it's time to talk about the recording environment. I have an embarrassing recording environment. When properly setting up your recording environment, there are two main factors that you want to control, namely reverb and noise. Now I'm sitting very close to my microphone, so it's more difficult to hear the reverb in my room, but if I step a little bit back from my microphone, it's very easy to tell that I'm in a small room with lots of reflections going on. And that's sort of the hallmark of a low-quality recording environment, because you can't extract that room sound using editing. It's just going to be stuck there. You can always add more reverb in post, but you can't take it away if it's been baked into the recording. Now, a DIY sound dampening solution that you can use if you're looking to reduce the reverb in a small room is by putting up curtains everywhere. Yes, this is a fire hazard. However, using excessive sound dampening can also make a room sound dead and unnatural. Actual sound treatment of a room is a subtle and technical discipline. Or at least that's how it seems to me, because it looks like black magic. Moving on to the other half of having a good recording environment, controlling noise. Turn off noise sources. Move away from noise if you can. Noise sources include your computer keyboard and mouse, your computer fan, appliances, construction noises, that train outside, and the jet flying over your building. When you cannot move away from noises or turn off your noise source,
try to take advantage of the directional cancellation of your microphone.
Lastly, for hardware, we're going to talk about the audio interface. Now, I mentioned the audio interface a few times in the microphone section, but I never explained what it was. Essentially, an audio interface is an external sound card. Now, say you, I already have a sound card. There's a sound card in my computer. It works perfectly fine. Why do I need an external sound card? That's like saying that you have an integrated GPU that comes with your CPU, so you don't need a dedicated graphics card. The audio interface is to your shitty integrated sound card what GigaChad Hitch is to this little bitch called Spike. It offers two main advantages over your shitty integrated sound card. Firstly, less noise. I don't know about you, but my laptop's integrated sound card is garbage. It introduces high-pitched noise that's even audible through my headphones without even trying to record anything. None of that with the Focusrite Scarlett Solo. Secondly, and this may seem counterintuitive, the audio interface offers lower latency, despite being external to your computer, meaning less delay between hitting a key on your MIDI keyboard or singing something and hearing it in your headphones. Rather important for musicians. Audio interfaces are often paired with their own special drivers on the OS end. This, in combination with the upgraded hardware, means that audio interfaces can dump audio to your headphones or monitors way faster than your integrated sound card, with less work from your CPU. Now, aside from offering less noise and less latency, audio interfaces also offer a range of connectors with which you can connect things like microphones to your computer. Recall in the microphone section that I said that condenser microphones require the use of something called 48-volt phantom power. Well, the way you get that power to a microphone is through an XLR cable. So if you buy a condenser microphone that uses 48-volt phantom power, you're also going to need an audio interface that can supply that power through an XLR connector. Aside from that, audio interfaces can offer various additional features. My audio interface, the Focusrite Scarlett Solo, has these little LED rings around the volume knobs for each input. These LED lights will flash yellow or red if my signal is clipping, something that we're going to talk a little bit more on later. Additionally, my audio interface offers something called direct monitoring or zero latency monitoring. Essentially, what this is a feature that allows me to listen to the input signals on the interface with zero latency through any headphones or speakers that I may have connected to the interface. This can be especially useful for troubleshooting recording problems. Now we're talking about the last section of recording, mic setup and technique. The main variable to consider here is positioning, and understanding how positioning can affect a whole bunch of other variables. For instance, positioning can affect the tone of your voice or your instrument.
This is how it sounds when I speak above my microphone. This is how it sounds when I speak from below my microphone. This is how it sounds when I speak from behind my microphone. This is how it sounds when I'm moving left to right in front of my microphone.
As you can hear, where you are relative to your microphone can have a big effect on your sound.
So that's something, as a vocalist or an instrumentalist, you might want to control. You might find it more convenient to use a particular mic stand, for example a boom mic stand, in order to maintain a consistent position relative to your microphone. Another factor that we want to consider with respect to positioning is something called the proximity effect.
This is an effect that is more pronounced on condenser microphones than dynamics. Basically, the closer you get to your mic, the more the bass frequencies and the sound that you're recording are emphasized.
During the recording of this video series, I have been exploiting the proximity effect heavily.
This is how it sounds when I'm only a few inches further away from my microphone.
So it seems that the proximity effect is great for us, right? The closer we are to our microphone, the more we can give an impression that we have a deep, manly voice. Well, there is a caveat, and the caveat is that the closer you are to your microphone, the more it's going to pick up weird noises from your mouth. Things like popping, sibilants, and mouth clicks are much more prominent when you're up close to your microphone than if you're further away.
Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. I can even do this without the pop field. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers.
Another variable that we need to consider in our mic setup or technique is how we set our gain levels or our volume levels. The number one thing that we want to avoid when recording is clipping. Clipping is harsh-sounding audio distortion that is introduced when the volume levels of our sound exceed the maximum bounds that can be processed by our computer.
And here's an example of what it sounds like when I'm clipping.
Again, just like with reverb,
you can always add distortion in post.
And it can be used as an artistic effect. However, if you bake it into the recording, there's no way to get it out.
And that concludes the recording section.
I know you're here for editing, right?
Editing is a thing that you do when you fail to do the right thing in the recording process. We use editing to exclude the bad noises that you failed to exclude from your recording and fix the errors with intonation and timing because you can't play your instrument. Totally not anything that happens to me. Anyways, when we edit, we are working with units of audio known as audio clips. In most DAWs, audio clips can be moved independently and layered on top of each other. Typically, these audio clips are generated by recordings, but they can also be rendered from your project, they can be synthesized, they can be sampled from other songs, lots of different ways you can get audio clips. Editing audio clips is one of the fundamental tasks of a DAW. If you do anything involving non-synthesized instruments, you will have to familiarize yourself with all the different commands used for editing in your particular DAW. There are a number of common ways that you can manipulate audio clips. One that I've already discussed is moving the clips in time, making the audio play earlier or later. We can also split audio clips. In some DAWs, this is called slicing or cutting. Splitting an audio clip splits it into two clips, about a split point. After you've split a clip, each of the two resulting clips can be manipulated independently, just like any other audio clip. And of course, just like many of the things on a computer, you can copy, cut, paste, and delete clips. Already, with just these few manipulations available to us, it becomes obvious how to solve certain problems with our recordings. For example, suppose that a clip has a mistake that we don't want. We simply split around the mistake and delete the middle clip, and thus we've gotten rid of our mistake. Suppose that we have a guitar part that comes in too early. All we have to do is move our clip a little bit to the right, that is, later in time, and our guitar part will play correctly, and so on and so forth. In addition to simply moving clips, most DAWs will also allow you to manipulate the pitch, speed, and volume of clips. Manipulating pitch can be used to adjust samples from a song into the correct key for our song, or it can also be used as a rudimentary form of pitch correction. Manipulating the speed of a clip can allow us to take a sample from another song, or a sample pack, and adjust it to the correct tempo for our song. It can also be used, to a limited extent, to correct the timing of our recorded instrument parts.
Manipulating pitch and speed of a clip can also be used as an artistic effect.
Manipulating the volume of our clip allows us, to an extent, to compensate for things like having an inconsistent recording setup that results in producing inconsistent volumes. Now, the mathematics and physics inclined among you may have noticed that there is supposed to be a dependency between speed and pitch. If I'm speeding up a clip, it should play at a higher frequency, right? Well, in the music production world, it's simply easier for us to think of these as separate variables. A note's duration is distinct from a note's pitch. So most digital audio workstations will actually allow you to adjust a clip's speed and pitch independently of each other. And the way they do this is through proprietary algorithms, such as Zplane's Elastic Pro time stretching algorithm. The last basic manipulation of clips that should be present in any DAW is the ability to add fades and crossfades. The reason you do this is to avoid sounds like this. Sloppy editing. The clicking or popping that you hear in the audio is a result of making an abrupt cut in the audio. Think about it this way, if I took a sound and then I put a cut in the middle of it to complete silence, essentially you're telling your speakers to go from position A to position B instantaneously, which ends up creating that clicking or popping sound. To avoid this, we need to use fades and crossfades. Fades are manipulations that gradually bring down a volume for clips, and they're suitable for working with clips that transition to silence. By using this gradual transition instead of an abrupt cut, we avoid the problems with clicking or popping. Crossfades, on the other hand, are similar to fades, but they also involve bringing the volume up of a second clip, so they are useful for sort of blending two different clips together, for example, two different takes of a vocal track. Now, in terms of my own work, most of my editing work goes into vocal tracks. Not surprising. Most of my vocal tracks, this one being no exception, are assembled from many different takes, often taking advantage of the ability to move, split, and delete clips to get rid of mistakes and adjust timing. When I do doubled vocal tracks or harmony tracks, I do my best to try to edit them to line up as closely as possible. Lastly, on vocal and guitar tracks, you can trim the quote-unquote silence, or the parts where they're not supposed to be playing or singing, in order to reduce unnecessary noises in your production. So those are just some examples of where I apply editing in my own productions.
And that's editing.
You know what, guys? I apologize. That is not editing. About 10% of the way into making the demo segment, I realized that I had not in fact covered any sort of MIDI editing in the editing section, which is embarrassing. So let's talk about MIDI editing. As you may recall from the introduction, MIDI is the musical language of computers. It's how we tell our virtual instruments or plugins which notes to play. That means that when we edit MIDI, we don't work with audio directly. Instead, we edit the MIDI data that controls our virtual instruments. That means editing things like the pitch, timing, or velocity of notes. MIDI editing in a DAW occurs for two main purposes. Firstly, if you don't have a MIDI keyboard or a pad controller with which to record MIDI playing, then editing is the only way that you're going to get any MIDI data into your virtual instruments and synths in the first place. Secondly, even if you do have a MIDI controller to record data, unless you're just a god-tier musician, you're gonna have to edit your recorded MIDI data in order to fix mistakes that you made while playing. Okay, so how do we get MIDI to work in our DAW? What specifically do we need to do? If we want to hear sounds when playing MIDI data, first we have to ensure that that data gets fed to a plugin that can accept MIDI data. Different DAWs have different means of accomplishing this. In Traction Waveform, what I have to do is put a virtual instrument on a track, arm MIDI recording on that track for a particular MIDI controller, such as a keyboard controller or a pad controller, start recording, and play my instrument. The MIDI keyboard and pad controller, however, are not the only ways to interact with MIDI. DAWs provide manual ways to input and edit MIDI data using your mouse and keyboard alone. The three main ways that this is done are through the piano roll, the step sequencer, and through MIDI clips. One type of MIDI editing is done in a piano roll. This is analogous to the piano roll used in player pianos. You draw notes on the piano roll, and when you press play in your DAW, the MIDI notes are played out on whatever plugin you have set up to receive them. The piano roll is most useful for tonal instruments where you care about what notes are being played. Most piano rolls will give you basic manipulations like adding and deleting notes, moving notes, changing the length of notes, changing the pitch of notes, cutting, copying, and pasting, as well as splitting notes using a knife tool. Compared to the step sequencer, the piano roll is generally more sophisticated, allowing for more complex manipulation of MIDI data. Speaking of more complex manipulation, MIDI data can convey more information than just what notes are being played and when. For example, MIDI messages can convey information about the velocity of notes, that is, how hard they are played. Most MIDI keyboards will automatically emit information about the velocity of the note being played as they are being used to record MIDI data. However, the piano roll can also be used to manually edit the velocity of notes. Besides note velocity, there are many, many other MIDI messages which can be emitted by hardware components that can be connected to or incorporated as part of a MIDI controller, and can also be manually manipulated using a typical piano roll. pitch bend wheel messages are messages emitted by the pitch bend wheel on a MIDI keyboard. This component acts as an easy way for a musician to shift the pitch of what is being played at the moment. Modulation wheel messages are another type of message sent by a MIDI keyboard via a modulation wheel. The modulation wheel on a MIDI keyboard allows a musician to easily manipulate one parameter of an instrument while the musician is recording. Expression pedal messages serve a similar purpose for expression pedals that can be hooked up to some synths and keyboards. Breath control messages are emitted by breath controllers, which are expensive, but these controllers can be hooked up to MIDI interfaces or keyboards and allow the musician to control a MIDI parameter in real time with their breath. This can be very valuable for simulated wind instruments, such as audio modeling and sample modeling's physically modeled instruments, which are recognized as some of the most physically accurate virtual instruments out there. Lastly, the sustain or hold pedal messages allow hardware sustain pedals, which you can hook up to your keyboards, to emulate the sustain pedal functionality on a piano. Typically, most synthesizer plugins will respond to the sustain pedal by causing any played notes to be held beyond releasing the key. There are many other MIDI message types beyond this, but those are just a few of the common ones. Now remember that everything is up to interpretation by the plugin that is using the MIDI data. While there is conventional behavior for a plugin to react a certain way based on MIDI messages it receives, it is not guaranteed that all plugins respond the same way to certain MIDI data. For example, certain plugins may not be velocity sensitive at all, or they may be programmable plugins that allow the user to manually map various MIDI messages to internal plugin parameters. Now that we've touched on other potential MIDI parameters, let's talk about the step sequencer. Another type of MIDI editing is done in something called a step sequencer. Essentially, what a step sequencer does is it offers a fixed set of steps where you can merely specify whether a note is being played or not. Some step sequencers also allow you to control the velocity of each step. Step sequencers typically offer much more limited control over MIDI parameters than piano rolls. They are meant to emulate the characteristics of hardware drum machines, which behaved much like step sequencers. Overall, they are meant to provide a more simplified approach to beat making. The piano roll can be used to make beats as well, but the step sequencer is confined to this role. It is typically not used for melodic information. Now, both the piano roll and the step sequencer allow for note level manipulation. That is, they allow you control over individual notes. However, most DAWs will also allow you to organize MIDI into clips, which you can manipulate similarly to audio clips that we discuss in the editing section. For instance, you can cut, copy, paste, split, and loop MIDI clips. The last thing I want to cover in this section are a few other MIDI manipulations. One of the most useful MIDI manipulations, at least for any music producer working digitally, is quantization, which allows us to lock the imperfectly timed notes of our recording into the tempo grid of our song. Quantization is one of the reasons that we are accused of having no actual musical skill. Groove and randomization are usually applied after quantization. They consist of applying small timing offsets to each note, so that not everything is strictly on beat. In other words, after you take the suckiness out of your timing, you add it back in so you sound more like a human instead of a computer. Another MIDI manipulation that can be performed is transposing notes, essentially shifting them up or down in pitch. Yet another MIDI manipulation that can be performed in some DAWs is strum. What strum does is it allows you to take notes that have been played in a chord all at once and play them at staggered times, much in the same way that you would when playing a guitar. Some DAWs also have special functionality for pattern generation as well as arpeggiation. Arpeggiation is a functionality that allows you to play the notes of a chord in a predefined sequence, or simply repeat the notes of a chord. Alright, I think I've covered everything that I want to cover for this MIDI editing section, so we will see you next time with writing. Welcome back. This is the writing section. You have not, in fact, escaped English class. Now, personally, I don't consider myself to be a very good songwriter. I still want to provide you with useful information, but here it's mostly taken from external resources. If I ever get good, I might make a better version of this video. I've decided to split this video into three parts. Number one, techniques for creative storytelling. Number two, the poetic elements of writing such as meter and rhyme scheme. And number three, rap. Yes, rap gets its own section. Now for me, when I think about lyrics and what purpose they serve in the song, what they do is make the story of your song concrete.
songs pretty much always have narratives to them. They have sections, they have tension and release, they have build-ups and climaxes. The downstream implication of this is that your lyrics should follow the musical format. For example, if you're writing a pop song, the chorus should probably be the part of your lyrics that's easiest to sing. The musical portion of the chorus and the lyrical portion of the chorus should line up to produce the section with the most power and the most hype. Like when Twilight Sparkle is commanding you to follow the science. Now, writing lyrics is a little different from writing a prose story. Most obviously, in English, lyrics are expected to rhyme. But more importantly, we have verses, and in between those verses, we have choruses that repeat over and over again. But most stories are not Groundhog Day, so how do we deal with this repeating element in our lyrics? The typical approach to this is to have our choruses express a general idea, and have our verses place that idea in different contexts. For example, in I Am the Science, Twilight is frustrated with the Povit skeptic, and she wants them to all shut up and follow the science. And in the verses, she describes all of the specific ways that she's frustrated. And note that there's a loose chronological progression that links all the verses together. In the first verse, she's talking about the 2 weeks to slow the spread. And then, in the second verse, she's talking about re-upping on your booster every week. Now, if you're the kind of person who has appreciation for vivid imagery or good stories in your lyrics, okay, boomer. But there are a few tips that may be helpful to you. I'm sure you've never heard this one before. Show, don't tell. A second pack of cigarettes. It's a slow night, but there's time yet. Here comes John from his other life. He may be driving to his wife, but he'll slow down, take a look. I've learned to read them just like books. It's already 10:30, but they'll be back again. Headlights in the rainy street. I check, make sure it's not the heat. I wink, I smile, I wave my hand. He stops and seems to understand the small transaction we must make. I tell him that my heart will break if he's not a generous man. I step into his van.
Wow, imagine how boring this song would be if Sting had just told us to our faces that he was a prostitute waiting for a customer.
Actually, I only have one other tip, and that's the first verse that you write does not actually have to be the first verse in the song. Sometimes you might have trouble writing the second verse. So a way you can reframe this is, instead of thinking, where do I go from here from the first verse, make the first verse the second verse and ask, how did I get to this point? And that's all I have to say about creative storytelling. Now it is time to dive deep into your high school English classes, because we're looking at the poetic elements of writing, and yes, there will be iambic pentameter. Just kidding, there will be no iambic pentameter here. But there will be meter, along with all the other piddling little things that people who analyze poems like to concern themselves with, like rhyme scheme and quality of rhyme. Sometimes, it can be helpful to have these concepts in the back of your head when you're writing lyrics. Let's start with the rhyme scheme. Most Western poetry and lyrics are based on rhyming, that is, having similar sounding words at the end of each line. Rhyme scheme describes the arrangement of rhymes throughout the entire lyric. We notate rhyme scheme by assigning each rhyme a letter. This is easiest to illustrate with an example, so let's use cupcakes. All you have to do is take a cup of flour. This is our first line, so it receives the letter A. Add it to the mix. Mix does not rhyme with flour, so we assign it a different letter, B. Now just take a little something sweet, not sour. This rhymes with flour, so we assign it the letter A. A bit of salt, just a pinch. Pinch kind of rhymes with mix, so we assign it the letter B. So we would say the rhyme scheme here is ABAB. Another small thing, the letter X is used to denote a line that does not rhyme with any other nearby lines. As Westerners, the most common rhyme schemes we encounter are ABAB or AABB, rhyming couplets. Vampire bats will give you a fright, eating apples both day and night. They rest for a minute, maybe three, then they're eating every apple in your apple tree. Rhyming couplets is a very common rhyming scheme in rap. With so much drama in the LBC, it's kinda hard being Snoop D-O-double-G, but I somehow, some way, keep coming up with funky-ass shit like every single day. Now, depending on who you ask, just because these rhyme schemes are common does not make them bad. In fact, it's because these rhyme schemes are so common that we can do interesting things with rhyme schemes. And here we arrive at the whole crux of this section. The idea that some songwriting theorists have is that if you do something that's unexpected in the context of messing with rhyme scheme or meter, the listener will pay more attention to it. So you can intentionally mess with the rhyme scheme to put something important there, such as the title of the song. A true, true friend helps a friend in need.
true, true friend helps a friend in need to see the light that shines from a true, true friend.
Now that we've talked about rhyme scheme, let's talk about quality of rhymes. The most basic rhymes we learned in English are perfect rhymes. These are pairs of words like end and send, or mail and fail, or double and trouble. But lyricists do not merely limit themselves to perfect rhymes. There are many other, less perfect kinds of rhymes out there, and you can see them on this screen. I'm not going to fucking read them off to you. Now again, the theory goes that the quality of rhymes can be manipulated to create tension and release. More unstable or imperfect rhymes can create more ambiguity in the rhyme scheme, and thus greater tension. But personally, I'm not sure that people pay that much attention to lyrics. Last and most infamous, meter. Meter is a way of characterizing the quote-unquote rhythm of verse. Only here, the term rhythm has nothing to do with musical rhythm. We describe verses as having beats, which have nothing to do with beats in music. Beats are actually stressed syllables in words. Iambic pentameter, the one from your English class, involves 5 beats, and it's more complicated than that, but iambic pentameter isn't important here. Now, poetic rhythm deals with how many and where the beats occur within lines. Common meter, so-called, is one of the most common meters used in Western music, and it involves an alternating arrangement of 4 beats per line and 3 beats per line. Most songs do not follow meters as closely as classical poetry does, but it can still be useful as a concept to have in the back of your head when you're analyzing or writing lyrics. For example, we can squeeze the verse of Winter Wrap-Up into the paradigm of common meter.
Time has come to welcome spring and all things warm and green. But it's also time to say goodbye. It's winter, we must clean.
Once again, the theory goes that interesting stuff happens once you start deviating from the meter, adding a different number of stresses per line. Again, the idea is that we're conditioned to expect certain patterns of meter, like common meter, but we can surprise the listener by deviating from that. Now in practice, before I knew about any of this meter stuff, I just wrote lyrics to an improvised melody. I'm not really sure that any of this poetic stuff is that important, but really I think the most important part is that you don't end up like Lil Pump.
100 on my wrist, 80 on my wrist.
What?
100 on my wrist, 80 on my wrist. 100 on my wrist, 80 on my wrist. 100 on my wrist, 80 on my wrist.
D-Rose, 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 D-Rose,
D-Rose.
Oh yeah, this is the rap section. The interesting thing about rap as a genre is that it focuses on wordplay and clever rhyming to provide part of the appeal of a song. This isn't something that you see in most other genres. In most rock, pop, or country songs, people don't care about how cleverly you can rhyme two words together. But in rap, you have people like Eminem whose entire careers are based off of how well they can twist words to rhyme with each other. When I'm and I'm don't rhyme with venom unless you're Eminem. So the genre conventions of rap give you a lot more leeway with wordplay. You can have more fun with how you play with language. You're almost expected to be less serious. You can rhyme multiple syllables. You can mess around with metaphors and similes and common turns of speech. You can split or twist the pronunciation of words to make them rhyme. And you can use puns.
Never even been charging connection with battery, bitch, you ain't plugged into nothing. Rap gods with lyrical bullets, we gets cocky partners, better tool up. This has not to do with muscular, but have guns for sure, you better put a strap on other words if you're gonna roll up with your gang. You gonna need an arsenal, cause this bar is over your head, so you better have arms if you're gonna pull up.
As a side note, there's a lot more than wordplay when it comes to making convincing rap. All the important rappers have their own unique style of interacting with rhythm. For example, and I think I mentioned this earlier, but a lot of West Coast rappers like Snoop Dogg and Be Real from Cypress Hill actually rap slightly behind the beat. There's a whole subcommunity of technical rappers like Eminem and Tech N9ne who use unique rhythmic constructions. The unique way in which each rapper interacts with rhythm and deciding things like what syllables to stress constitute what is known as flow. And if you're looking to get into rap, then people are going to be interested in seeing you develop your flow. Okay, I'm gonna stop myself there. I'm not one of those people who grew up with rap music, and it's almost 2 a.m. Next time, however, you can look forward to the only section that anybody really cares about, mixing. Today it is time to talk about the highly mystified concept of mixing. What is that DJ doing?
Why are there so many live-action music videos of engineers sitting behind mixing desks, turning knobs and adjusting faders? Mixing is all about controlling aspects of sound beyond what instrument we use, what notes we play, or what recording equipment we use. In the modern day, we do most of our mixing using digital effects, things like EQ, filters, compressors. These are all things that are going to be explained later in greater detail. In the context of music production, mixing plays several roles. Firstly, mixing can be used to control unwanted noises or unwanted resonances, and generally provide desirable characteristics to our sound. It can be used to make important elements of our music intelligible, ensuring that we can hear all of the important parts being played by each instrument, and it can help contribute to the feel of our song. Creative uses of digital effects can also be used to make interesting sounds. To start off with the very basics, we're going to talk about three aspects of our sound that we commonly adjust during mixing. These are volume, which also involves balance and dynamics, panning, and color or frequency content. Volume is simply how loud or how soft a sound is. Every DAW should have some kind of fader option for adjusting the volume of a track. One of the most basic aspects of audio mixing is getting the right balance in volume levels. In fact, some people say that this is 80% of the mixing process. Simply setting your tracks to sit at a good volume relative to each other will give you a good foundation for any other additional mixing that you want to do. When we're deciding to adjust the volume of each track, what we're thinking about is what instruments are important and need to sit in the foreground, usually things like singing, lead guitar, bass, drums, lead synths. Because we want these instruments to stand out, we need to make them louder. Or what instruments are auxiliary, maybe things like supporting percussion, or rhythm guitar, or synth pads. Instruments that we place in these roles, we might want to make quieter. And within the foreground, or the background, we want to make sure that there is balance between different instruments that are equally important. We want them to be perceived as equally loud. What you don't want to have is a situation where you have an important instrument that is too quiet, or if you've made an instrument way too loud to the point where it prevents anything else from being heard. Another common pitfall in balancing is trying to make everything the same loudness. Just because it's called balance doesn't mean that everything has to be the same. Remember, your listener can only pay attention to so much at once. If you have a complex musical arrangement and you make everything equally loud, the listener won't know what to focus on, so it can be very confusing. Another aspect of sound tied to volume is dynamics. Dynamics is essentially how much the loudness of a sound varies over time. It is important to note that dynamics is a distinct concept from loudness. If you have a high level of dynamics, that doesn't mean that your sound is very loud. What it means is that your sound could go from really quiet to really loud, whereas a sound with a low level of dynamics stays at pretty much the same loudness throughout. We control dynamics using digital effects called compressors, gates, and expanders. Again, we're going to cover effects in greater detail later. Now let's talk about why and where we would want to use a high level versus a low level of dynamics. In general, dynamics has an inverse relationship with intelligibility. The more dynamic a sound is, the harder it is to make out in a mix. Part of this goes back to the concept of balance. It's much easier to balance two instruments whose loudness levels don't vary very much, in contrast to two instruments with a high level of dynamics. In some genres of music, having a high level of dynamics is the standard, for instance, in classical music. In classical music, the dynamics created by the player of an instrument are considered to be an important part of the musical expression. But also, if we think about something like a solo piano or a solo violin piece, since there's only one instrument, balance is not a big concern. So we can easily achieve a high level of dynamics while still maintaining intelligibility. However, this does not mean that just because we might not be producing classical music doesn't mean that we can just squash our dynamics down to zero using a compressor. Sounds with low dynamics are perceived as louder than sounds with high dynamics. They're also more intelligible. However, having too low of a level of dynamics can make your sound very tiring to listen to. In addition, reducing the dynamic range of a recording can bring out unwanted noises by bringing the loudness of the unwanted noise closer to the loudness of the instrument or the vocal in the recording. Now note that I said that a sound with low dynamics is generally perceived as being louder than a sound with high dynamics. Keyword perceived. Now as you learn more about mixing from this video as well as from external resources, you're going to learn about things like meters and spectrum analyzers.
which are all ways of visualizing the loudness and tonal characteristics of our sound. These tools can be helpful, but they can also sometimes be misleading. So a general principle to follow when mixing is to trust your ears more than you trust your meters. Now lastly, before we get into panning, let's talk about something called headroom. As we discussed in the recording section, just as a microphone clips when your gain is set too high, your software can clip if you're playing music or sounds with the volume level that's too high. Think about this, most music is composed from multiple sounds. So even if you have two sounds that aren't clipping on their own, but they're just below clipping, if you combine them together, their combined loudness may cause clipping. So one thing that you want to try to do is to leave headroom in your tracks. That is to set the volume of each track in your software low enough that the combined mix doesn't clip. Of course, this means that if you were to render your track as it was with a lot of headroom, it would be very quiet in a browser or on music playing software. That takes us into the role of mastering, which is performed after mixing, and will be discussed later. Okay, let's talk about panning. If we think about a stereo system, that is, any system with two speakers for the left and right side of our heads, panning is whether something is being played more on the left side of the stereo field or on the right side. And that means that if you're listening to this on a mono system, you didn't hear the panning. Now, there are a couple of things that panning can do for our mixes. Firstly, panning can be used to create separation between tonally similar instruments or conflicting elements in our mix to help them be more intelligible. However, if you recall from the listening section, not all systems are stereo or surround systems. And under certain circumstances, some systems won't behave like stereo systems. For example, listening to stereo speakers at a distance. So using panning alone as a strategy to make certain instruments or sounds more intelligible in a mix won't work for those systems. Back to the role of panning, panning can be used to de-emphasize instruments or sounds in a mix. Sounds placed to the side of a mix tend to be perceived as less important than those in the center. And lastly, one of our favorite tricks in ASMR, hard panning can make an object sound uncomfortably close to one ear or the other, which may or may not be an effect that you desire. Last of the aspects of sound that we can adjust is color or frequency content, but before that, we're going to start with a primer on frequency content. What the heck do I mean by frequency content? Let's start from the very basics. Sound is the vibration of air particles. When we hear an instrument producing a sound, we hear a pitch. What we perceive as the pitch, or how high or low the sound is called the frequency. Physically, the frequency is the number of times per second that a wave of sound oscillates. The units of frequency are hertz, one cycle per second. You can see the animation here. We have a wave of high frequency, and now a wave of low frequency. Now, not all sounds produce a perceptible pitch. For example, a drum has no perceptible pitch in general. But these sounds have frequency content. They can be thought of as being composed of many different sound waves at different frequencies. As a matter of fact, most instruments have frequency content beyond that pitch that we perceive. That's what makes them sound like those instruments. That's part of what makes a piano sound like a piano as opposed to a saxophone. The only instrument that doesn't have any additional frequency content compared to the pitch that we perceive is the synthesized sine wave. Now in mixing, the quote-unquote color of a sound refers to the frequency content of that sound and whether it's predominantly made from high frequency sound waves or low frequency sound waves. High frequencies make sounds sharp and shrill. Examples with sounds with predominantly high frequency content are screaming, hi-hats, and cymbals. In mixing, we use the term bright to describe sounds with a lot of high frequency content. Low frequency content, on the other hand, makes sounds deep and rumbly. Think earthquakes or kick drums. In mixing, we refer to sounds with a lot of low frequency content as warm or dark. And we don't just need to use these terms to describe sounds. We can apply the language of color, bright, warm, or dark, to mixes of entire songs. So let's do that. First, let's look at the track Residence by Home. This track has very little high frequency content, so we would describe it as being warm. can see here how color affects the feel of the track. It's a very nostalgic sound, and the reason for this is that, in general, retro equipment does not reproduce high frequencies as well as digital equipment. So music with a dark or warm mix almost makes us feel that it came from an earlier time, even if this song was only released in 2014. Now let's take a look at a song that showcases more of the middle range of frequency content, Polkadot Stingray's Telecaster Stripe. This is an indie rock song with the vocals and lead guitar emphasized in the 1-3 kHz range. This is approximately the range of frequencies that biologically we're most sensitive to. The point of the emphasis in this range is to increase the intelligibility on vocals and lead guitar on all sound systems. Generally, most sound systems will be able to reproduce this middle range quite well, even if they're really cheap speakers. And lastly, let's look at Earth, Wind & Fire's Fantasy for an example of emphasis in high frequency content. In this song, you can really hear the high frequencies in the hi-hats. Compared to the last song, the high frequencies are really emphasized due to the fact that this song has less mid-range frequency content. Sometimes the mixing is more about what you take out than what you put in. Overall, the increased high frequency content makes the whole production feel crisp and hi-fi. As producers, we can control the color of our songs based on what instruments we choose to use, what instruments we choose to emphasize in the mix, and the use of digital effects. The primary effects that we use for manipulating the frequency content, or color, of sounds are filters and EQ. We primarily do this to ensure that instruments that we want to be intelligible are intelligible, and to remove unwanted resonances from our sounds. Alright, so I've been doing a lot of referring to effects. Let's talk about effects. Effects are hardware units or software plugins that we can use to alter the characteristics of sound. The main effects that I'm going to cover here are compression, gating, and EQ and filtering. Compression mostly has to do with dynamics. A compressor reduces the volume of a sound when it increases above a threshold. In effect, it keeps the quiet parts of the sound quiet and makes the loud parts softer. Now, typically after this is done, there is a makeup gain stage which boosts the volume of the overall sound, so the net effect is actually making the quieter parts of your sound louder. The primary purpose of compression is to reduce the dynamics of a sound. Remember, having lower dynamics in a sound helps us with balance and intelligibility, and it increases the perceived loudness of the sound. However, the downside is that noises in a recording that you apply compression to become much more audible relative to the sound of interest, and abusing compression to reduce the dynamics down to almost zero can really tire out the listener's ears. To demonstrate this effect, I am now going to apply a large amount of compression to my voice. You can now hear a lot of the ambient noise around me. You can also hear the construction noises going on in the background. Amazing. Let's also demonstrate the effect of compression on music. Let's crank that to 11. So hopefully you can tell how that increased the perceived loudness of the song, and hopefully you can hear why that would become tiring to listen to if abused. Next, we're going to talk about gating. Gating is the opposite of a compressor.
it reduces the volume of a sound when it falls below a certain threshold. Gating is commonly used as a technique to automatically remove noise from recordings. For example, the voice you hear right now is currently being run through a gate. But listen to what happens when I turn that off. You may be able to hear my computer fan running in the background. Lastly, let's get to effects that allow us to manipulate the color of a sound, EQ and filtering. EQ and filter effects sculpt the frequency content of our sound. The two most basic kinds of filters are high-pass filters and low-pass filters. High-pass filters allow high frequencies to pass, but they remove low frequencies. This is what my voice sounds like with a high-pass filter on it. Low-pass filters, on the other hand, remove high frequencies. This is what my voice sounds like with a low-pass filter on it. EQs are essentially large arrays of filters that can be configured to amplify or decrease certain frequencies in a sound. If I apply an EQ to my voice, I can choose to boost the low frequencies, boost the medium frequencies, or boost the high frequencies. I can also choose to cut these frequencies. I can choose to cut high frequencies, cut medium frequencies, cut low frequencies. So now that we have an idea of what EQ and filters do, how do we use them to achieve the things that we're trying to do with mixing? Things like achieving separation between instruments. The general principle behind EQ and filtering is that if we want two instruments to stand apart from each other, we need to make sure that, in terms of frequency content, they're occupying different parts of the frequency range. To demonstrate this, I'm going to take two tonally similar instrument parts and then separate them using EQ. Now let's boost some 2 kHz on the piano and cut that on the guitar. Notice how the piano now seems to stand out a little more than the guitar. Now these sounds might not seem to sound as good as the original when standing on their own, but in the context of a full mix, your instruments will play much better together if they are not occupying the same frequency ranges. This is another important tip with mixing. Once we get to the mixing stage, we don't care how bad our instruments sound in isolation, we care about the whole finished product. Now another more specific mixing tip relating to EQ and filters. Generally, you want to keep other instruments out of the way of the bass and the kick drum. So you should be applying a high-pass filter on all of those instruments because generally, most of them don't even need those bass range frequencies to be intelligible in the first place. Now there's an exercise called frequency sweeping which you can do to familiarize yourself with the sound of different frequencies, which is a useful skill to have for mixers. Basically, in frequency sweeping, you take an EQ and you boost a particular frequency all the way up. Then, you sweep the frequency that's boosted around as you want. Your objective when you're doing this is basically to analyze what's going on where. You can do this on a sound, on a recording of an instrument, or you can analyze an existing song and figure out what frequency ranges different instruments occupy. That can help you get a better feel for the different ways that people approach mixing tracks. You can also use frequency sweeping on your own recordings to identify unwanted resonances or noises if they're dominant in any particular frequency range. In other words, you can boost to figure out where to cut. Let's try this on Call in the Border Patrol. As we move between different frequency ranges, take notes on what you hear and what you don't hear. Another technique involved in mixing is something called reference mixing. As I believe I mentioned in the listening section, when you listen to your own track over and over again for long periods of time with no breaks, it can alter your hearing perception. Reference mixing is one way to counteract this. It's also a way to compensate for listening to your track on different sound systems. Essentially, in reference mixing, you pick another song or track that you compare the mixing of your track to. Ideally, the reference mix is a song that you're familiar with and you know how it sounds on a particular sound system. You compare things like the balance between different instruments, the dynamics of each instrument, as well as the overall color of the mix. And this allows you to sort of anchor your mix to another track so you can still make good mixing decisions even if you are suffering from listening fatigue or listening in less than ideal conditions. I've talked a lot about the very pragmatic, practical aspects of mixing, like ensuring that instruments have adequate separation from each other, but what about the artistic side? We can also use the same tools that we use in mixing, our digital effects, to add novel characteristics to our sound. We can alter dynamics or color to create interest and a unique sound. For example, it's very common to apply a compressor to drum recordings. When configured properly, this compressor can make the drums sound punchier. For an example of an artistic use of EQ and filtering, it's very common in electronic music to apply a filter to the whole track to create a transition between different sections. I use this technique on Winter Wrap-Up, applying a high-pass filter to a transitional section in order to build tension. Of course, when thinking autistically, I mean artistically, we don't have to limit ourselves to the standard utility effects like compression and EQ. There are innumerable other effects that are used for artistic purposes during mixing. The only ones that we're going to focus on today are reverb and delay. Reverb is a type of effect that simulates the echoing sound of a physical space. In general, the more reverb that you have on a sound, the more it will be perceived as occurring in a larger space or being more distant from you. Because they are perceived as being more distant, sounds that have more reverb on them are generally perceived as less important in the mix. Reverb can also be used to take harsh sounds or harsh recordings and make them sound a little bit smoother, but you can push this too far. In fact, it is a very common pitfall for beginners to use way too much reverb on a track. Abuse of reverb can quickly reduce intelligibility and muddy up your mix. This is especially true if your song involves a lot of dense instrumentation. The rule of thumb when using reverb is use just enough reverb that you can feel it, not hear it. A delay can be thought of as a more primitive form of a reverb. What a delay does is it simply repeats a sound it receives at a delay and at a lower volume. In general, delays allow you to achieve the same practical effects as a reverb. They can make a sound feel more distant, but they have better intelligibility than a reverb. However, they sound nothing like an actual space. An interesting thing that you can do with delays is sync them to the tempo of your song. So delays can also be used to emphasize certain rhythms or make your song rhythmically feel tighter. One example of where I use delays artistically is in my cover of Sinking Ships, where I use a delay to emphasize certain words in the chorus. And for the last part of this section, let's talk a little bit about mastering. Now, I am not a mastering engineer, but me talking about things I have very little personal experience in is apparently a running theme of this presentation. Now, mastering uses many of the same tools as mixing, but later on in the process, when most of the tracks have been mixed down and effectively the final song has been rendered. So just like mixing engineers, mastering engineers use EQ and compression. The two main objectives of mastering are number one, to create cohesiveness in albums and playlists. The main thing that you're looking for is to make sure that tracks within an album play at similar volume levels so your listeners don't have to keep adjusting the volume knob. The second objective mastering is to make albums radio ready, essentially ensuring that the songs sound good and are intelligible on many different sound systems, everything from shitty phone speakers to car speakers to headphones or a full-blown home listening system. How is mastering done? Frankly, I have no idea. It's not something that I've really looked into, although I really should. That's a shitty way to conclude this section, but here we are. I'm recording this a month out from the MLPCon, and I have a lot of other deadlines in my life. So that's it for this section. Next time, we are going to talk about sound design. Peace out. Welcome to the penultimate element of music production, sound design. Now, I use the term sound design a little bit more loosely than other people. For me, sound design can include decisions like which samples and sounds to use, which presets on a synth to use, but it can also mean more complicated techniques that are entire disciplines in themselves. Synthesis, creative sampling, recording, and using effects to shape your sounds. I would definitely consider sound design to be one of my weaker areas. I don't really consider myself to be a sound designer, but it is part of what I do. Now let's get started with some basic terminology. Samples are little bits of audio that we integrate into our music. They can be recorded sounds, they can be subsections of other audio, such as sampling songs, or they can be synthesized. They are distinct from synthesized sounds in that synthesized sounds are created in real time using calculations by computers. Sampled sounds are stored in memory. Most DAWs will allow you to directly add samples into your music. However, another way we can integrate samples into our music is by loading them into sampler plugins. And these plugins essentially allow us to interact with the sound using MIDI, so we can play them using, for example, a MIDI keyboard. Synthesis, on the other hand, is usually conducted using synthesis plugins. Okay, now that I've gotten the basics out of the way, it's time to get back to theoreticals. Do we approach sound design as if it has a process? There's no specific process or unitary set of tools for sound design, but it can be guided by a number of considerations. The first consideration is trying to create a unique sound. I really feel like I achieved this best on the Mirrorwave album. Another consideration is that a lot of genres have certain sounds that are idiomatic to them. The Lindrum drum machine, for example, was very popular in 80s music. The TR-808 drum machine was very common in gangster rap. Woke up quick at about noon, just thought that I had to be in Compton soon. I gotta get drunk before the day begins, before my mother starts bitching about my friends. And the 808 drum machine remains a common feature of modern trap and drill music. The Yamaha DX7 piano patch was very popular in 80s R&B, pop, and jazz fusion music. For a more recent and pertinent example, we can look at vocal chopping, such as that used in early Brony music. Vocal chopping is a particularly interesting instance of sound design, because its unique sound comes very much both from the source material and what was done with the sound afterwards. The last consideration that I would say is involved in sound design is mixing considerations. That is, making sure that you pick sounds that can mesh together well, making sure that you have sounds that don't eat up too much of the same frequency ranges within your mix. Now, in terms of actually finding samples that you don't record yourself, I have listed a few sources on this slide. 99sounds.org, YouTube, freesound.org, vstbuzz.com, and the Bedroom Producers blog. Also a shout out to Clipper's master file from the Pony Preservation Project thread. This file contains labeled sound effects taken directly from the show. So these are all good places that you can get samples from to use directly in your DAW or use via a sampler plugin. Synthesis. Again, synthesis is the act of real-time generation of sound, and in digital music production, it's typically done using synth plugins. Subtractive synthesis is one of the most basic forms of synthesis. It generates sound using a repeating waveform, usually a sine, square, triangle, or saw wave, and then uses filters, the same kinds of filters that we talked about during the mixing section, to shape that sound. Subtractive synthesis is responsible for many of the classic synth sounds of the 70s. Because subtractive synthesis is so simple, there will be a mini demo at the end of this video demonstrating basic sound design using subtractive synthesis. Now, the other methods of synthesis listed here are more complicated, so I won't go into detail about them. However, I will note, at least at the time that this video is being made in 2022, most of the synth sounds that you hear being generated in modern electronic music are being generated through wavetable synthesis. Now, before we get to the synthesis demo, I want to touch briefly on effects. Again, as we showed in the mixing and mastering slides, there are too many effects out there to name. So instead, in terms of sound design, I'm just going to pick a few highlights. One really simple trick that I like to use is rendering out an instrument. And then reversing that sound to give me a transition. I'm also a big fan of using the Bit Crusher sound effect on pretty much everything. For all you computer and signal processing nerds out there, a Bit Crusher is essentially an audio effect that takes advantage of the quantization error produced when you reduce the sample rate of a sound. It might remind you of a toy you had, or an old video game that you played, where the sounds sounded like this.
But here's an example of where I've used a Bit Crusher in a musical context. That concludes the informational part of the sound design section. If you stay, we're going to do a little demo of subtractive synthesis. Alright, so what you're looking at here is Forosk, the standard synthesizer that comes with Traction Waveform Free. The main reason I chose this synthesizer is that it is relatively simple to deal with. Now I'm going to adjust a few settings from the default patch just to give us a good starting point. So the main thing we're looking at right now is the first line in this top panel, which is our first oscillator. This is essentially what produces the sound. You may recall when I was talking about subtractive synthesis earlier that we synthesize sounds using different waveforms. Well, this is how we select which waveform to use. There is a drop-down menu here, but unfortunately you can't seem to see it in this recording. So you're just going to have to imagine that there's a drop-down menu there that tells you all the different waveforms that you can use. Sine wave, square wave, saw wave, or triangle wave. For the purposes of this demo, I'm going to use a square wave. And that's going to sound like this. Very digital sounding. Now let's talk about what's going on this bottom panel. What we're seeing down here is something called the amplitude envelope. What it does is it alters the way the volume of the oscillator changes as I press down a key, hold it down, and then release it. Right now, there's pretty much nothing interesting going on here. You can see we have this sustain knob pretty much turned all the way up. So these four knobs, ADSR, have particular functions. A stands for attack, D stands for decay, S stands for sustain, and R stands for release. Now, what do they do? Well, S, standing for sustain, describes the volume that our oscillator is held at while we press down a key. Right now it's at 100%, so if I hold this down, it plays at 100% volume for the entire time that I'm holding down the key. Next, let's address attack. If we increase attack, what that does is it introduces a fade-in to our oscillator as we press the key. So let's increase the attack and see what it sounds like. Now you can hear that the oscillator doesn't start instantly at full volume. Instead, it has a slow ramp up. This can be useful for synthesizing sounds like synth pads or soft strings. Now let's talk about decay. If I raise decay right now, it's not going to do anything. And the reason that is because my sustain is all the way up. You see, what decay does is after the attack stage, decay causes the volume to slowly go down to the sustain volume, where it's held until you release the key. So instead of having a continuous sustain sound that plays at a constant volume, I can have a sound that starts loud and then gets softer, kind of like a guitar string or a piano key. Now there's one final parameter that we haven't talked about, and it's called release. What release does is instead of cutting off the sound immediately after I release the key, increasing the release knob causes the sound to trail off after I release the key. So that's going to sound something like this. Now let's turn the release back down again. As you can hear, with zero release, the sound cuts off immediately after I release the key. You're going to see some variation of these knobs in almost every single subtractive synthesizer out there. So if you're getting into synthesis, it's a good idea to familiarize yourself with them. Now let's get into filtering. That's this middle panel here. I'm going to turn on a low-pass filter by clicking on this button labeled LP. Now we have a low-pass filter on our sound. And it sounds warmer. Remember, a low-pass filter allows low frequencies to pass, but cuts out the harsh, shrill high frequencies. So let's mess around with our low-pass filter a little bit. Now that's neat and all, but I don't want to be messing around with my mouse while I'm trying to play my synthesizer at the same time. So if you go to this knob down here, what you see is something called the envelope amount. But this isn't the amplitude envelope that affects the oscillator, this is an envelope that affects the low-pass filter's cutoff frequency. Right now it is set to 0%, which means that there is no envelope affecting the filter frequency. So let's turn it all the way up, and let's hear what this sounds like. Now if you go over to the right side, you're going to see some very familiar looking controls. It's the same ADSR controls that were used in our amplitude envelope. Only instead of affecting the volume of our oscillator, it's affecting the cutoff frequency of our filter. And you can see that it's got a little bit of attack, which means that the cutoff frequency ramps up slowly as we press the key. If I brought the attack down to zero, it would sound like this. So hopefully from that, you've gotten sort of a grasp of the basic workings here. We have an oscillator being modified by a low-pass filter. The volume of the oscillator is being modulated by the amplitude envelope at the bottom, and the low-pass filter's cutoff frequency is being modulated by the envelope on the middle right. Now let's go into some extra things. Down here, we have an amplitude envelope, but most synths will also give you a few extra envelopes and something called an LFO, low-frequency oscillator, which you can use to modulate additional parameters in a similar fashion to the envelope used on the filter. So here I have envelope number one, and I'm going to use that to modulate the pulse width. Don't worry about what that is. All you need to recognize is that the sound is changing with the envelope. Okay, so that might be a little fast. Let's make that decay longer so it's easier to hear. And there we go, so we've created a second envelope that is modulating our pulse width over a long 8-second decay time. There is one more thing that I would like to cover here, that is an LFO. An LFO is kind of like an envelope in that it can be used to modulate the parameters of your synth, but it's different from an envelope in that it doesn't have anything to do with pressing a key, holding it down, or releasing it. Instead, as you can see from this animation here, an LFO is just kind of going all the time. It puts out a high signal, and then it puts out a low signal, and it does that over and over again. So let's use an LFO to modulate our filter frequency. See if you can guess what's going to happen. As you can see, our LFO is periodically increasing and decreasing our cutoff frequency for our filter. Now to cap all of this off, let's go into time-lapse mode, and I'm going to try to come up with something that sounds a little nice. I really don't remember why I called this section technology as opposed to just software, but here we are. The clock has struck midnight, and it is time for the final element of music production. We're going to be covering three things here. Virtual instruments and effects, specifically where to get them. That thing that makes us special, the Pony Preservation Project. All credit to autists who aren't me, by the way. And utility software such as YouTube DL and FFmpeg. This slide has information on some websites where you can get free virtual instruments, namely bedroomproducersblog.com and vstbuzz.com. Both websites host a wide range of freebies, as well as news on deals from plugin websites if you want to purchase plugins legally. If you don't care about that, then ask around. Now, there are a few other ways that you can get freebies from time to time or under particular circumstances. For example, some plugin vendors may put some plugins up for free as part of a limited offer from time to time, most likely to encourage you to compulsively check their websites. For example, I got Isotope's Ozone Elements for free as part of a limited offer, and I also know that Native Instruments Hybrid Keys instrument was offered for free at the same time. If you're considering purchasing musical hardware from a place that isn't eBay, note that some hardware manufacturers actually like to bundle some software with your purchase. Now, some of them bundle DAWs like Ableton Live Lite or Pro Tools First, which actually has been discontinued, but in my experience, the DAWs that are bundled with hardware are usually like extremely restricted versions of the actual DAWs that are just basically designed to get you to buy the real thing. But some of them are actually nice, so if you'll excuse the shilling, my purchase of the Focusrite Solo Audio Interface came with the Softube Drummer S73 Intelligent Master Processor, essentially a glorified multiband compressor that I've developed a habit of putting on a lot of things in my mixes. Now, in terms of my favorite legally free plugins, I would suggest Native Instruments Complete Start, which has a nice bass synth called the TRK-01 Bass Synth, a tube compressor called Supercharger, which you have to get because of the meme, right? And some nice preset sounds from the Analog Dreams and Hybrid Keys instruments. Of course, I have to mention Vital Synth, a free wavetable synth, which is probably the most powerful free synth, like, ever, with the caveat that it seems to be extremely CPU intensive. If for some reason your DAW doesn't come pre-bundled with basic effects, you may want to look into the Replugs VST FX suite. These are the same plugins that are used in the Reaper DAW, but you could use them anywhere. It'll provide all the basic effects that you'll need, and more. All with a no-nonsense UI. In the same vein, Melda Production offers a wide range of free effects, including M Auto Pitch, one of the few free pitch correction plugins out there. For more acoustic sounds, you may want to take a look at the Spitfire Labs instrument, for which you can download a lot of great free sampled sounds. Okay, that's enough shilling for music software companies. Time to talk about something that's a little bit less corporate, the Pony Preservation Project. The two pieces of the PPP that mostly feature in my work are 15.ai for generating dialogue and TalkNet for generating singing. Now, in delivering the following information, I'm going to assume that most people watching this already have a baseline level of familiarity with the PPP and how to use its various tools. One reason for this is because the PPP have their own panel, and you should check it out. But secondly, in my opinion, the documentation included with these tools is adequate enough that most people should be able to get up and running without a dedicated video tutorial. In other words, if you have no idea what the PPP is about or if you've never used any of the tools, this section might not be that useful to you. Now I'm going to provide a basic overview of how I use these tools, as well as a few tips and caveats that I've run into while trying to use them. So the way I use 15.ai is I simply write out a script beforehand and then I generate my script using 15.py, my special in-house read-evaluate print loop that lets me generate and download sounds entirely using my keyboard without even having to go to the 15.ai website. I made this thing so long ago that frankly I don't remember how it works. I don't remember all of the bugs that were associated with it. But if I had to make it again, I would make some kind of GUI or even a TUI program that's still keyboard operable, but also has the additional benefit of allowing you to queue multiple requests in parallel, so you can continue to generate while you're reviewing lines to figure out which ones to keep and which ones to throw out. But now let's talk about generating lines. If the pronunciation of words is off, your number one go-to is Arpabet. If the prosody is off, there are multiple options. One thing that you can try to do is alter the length of the sentence that you're generating.
I find that shorter lines are generally more emotive. Another solution that you can use is splitting your line into multiple segments and generating those different segments to stitch them together. But in practice, I find it's very difficult to get two independently generated segments to stitch well together. Another thing you can do is use the emotional contextualizer feature. In my opinion, I haven't really found a reliable relation between the line used for emotional contextualization and the actual emotion or delivery of the line itself. But it is possible to use the contextualizer to get a different result. As you can see, a lot of this is just trial and error. Another thing you can do is use punctuation creatively. Of course, you can use commas, periods, exclamation marks, and question marks, but you don't have to use punctuation in the way that it's used in English. You can also try mixing and matching different punctuation marks, like you mix and matched your vaccines. I also find that some characters are less emotive than others. More recent iterations of the model seem to have some issue with Twilight Sparkle in this area. Another thing that you can do is, if you can't get the AI to generate the line in a way that you want, you can try to tune the script to the tone that the AI is going for. In other words, work with the AI, not against it. In terms of a few miscellaneous tricks, I found in some cases that it's possible to extend vowel sounds using H.
What a shock. What a shock.
Also, you may recall that it's possible to get these sounds. As I generate all of my lines, they are saved in a folder dedicated to my project. When I go to edit the lines and incorporate them into the song or skit, I'm either cutting noises through manual editing or using noise gating. I find that the voices generated by 15.ai don't need too much mucking with in terms of EQ, so I don't really have a set of EQ recommendations across the board, but sometimes I use EQ to remove some harshness or boxiness from the lines. I also find that these voices can benefit from a little bit of compression for intelligibility. Now let's talk about what I do with TalkNet. What I like to do is write out my lyrics, and then I maintain a second version of the lyrics based on that. The second version of the lyrics is for holding fixes to pronunciation errors. Unlike 15.ai, TalkNet is deterministic, so you can't just regenerate your line in hopes of getting a new line without an error if you encounter one. Now, if you have the hardware to run TalkNet locally, I highly recommend it. You can find the link to the offline installer in the PPP main doc. The reasons that I recommend you run locally are as follows. There are a lot of small obstacles that can get in your way when you try to use Colab. For instance, Colab will error out if you try to upload too many files at once. Not a problem if you're running on your local machine. Colab is subject to timeouts. It's not if you're running on your local machine. And there's about 12 minutes of overhead that you encounter when you have to re-download all the files you need to run TalkNet when you first go to set it up on Colab. Not the case on your local machine. Because there's so much overhead involved here, running TalkNet on Colab is really not conducive to just dropping in and fixing a single error. Now, in generating TalkNet vocals, I take heavy advantage of the vocal doubling technique. What this is a common technique used in actual popular music, but it usually sounds much better in pop music than when I do it. Essentially, you record and generate two versions of the same line, and then pan them off to two sides of the mix. One reason that people do this is to add some width to the vocals. But the second reason that I do it that has more to do with TalkNet itself is that the AI is accurate but not precise. It can get around the right place with a given line, but it still craps out from time to time. So I try to average out the error from generation using vocal doubling. When writing a melody, it can be helpful to do a sanity check by generating a few mock lines first. The reason that this is a good idea is that if your melody goes outside the vocal range that the model can handle, the AI can start detecting the wrong octave, which can result in weird things happening in the generated audio. If you do a mock-up and the AI starts generating in the wrong octave, that might be a sign that you need to go and change the melody. It's been suggested that one thing that you could do in this case is use the change input pitch function in order to shift the melody into a more tolerable range for the AI, and then readjusting the pitch in post. In practice, I found that this is rarely feasible. In fact, I think there is even an example of this in Pi Day that resulted in some weirdness in the final product that I'm really not happy with. Another thing to note when writing out your melody is that the AI tends to struggle with sustained notes. I've heard from some anons that you can make multiple generations of these sustained notes and stitch together only the good parts. Sounds plausible, but personally, I haven't tried this, so. So the way this goes is essentially I do a source audio mockup where I record every line that I need in the DAW first and place it and edit it as though my vocals are the ones that are going to go into the final mix. From my DAW interface, what I can then do is split my audio and render it out into logical segments that I can then feed into TalkNet. Typically, this will be a verse, a chorus, maybe half a verse. My recommendation for the duration of each of these segments is that they should be less than a minute, and ideally around 30 seconds just to be safe. The reason that you care about duration is trying to process clips that are too long can result in you running out of RAM. As I'm rendering out my audio, I'm also relabeling it so I know what goes where. I like to use a song letter number system, where the song is a tag that tells me what song the file is for, the letter denotes the vocal track, and the number denotes the order of the clips. Sometimes I'm not just generating a double, I may have two or four tracks of backing vocals as well. When recording audio, one thing I've noticed is that the quality of the source audio is actually important for getting proper generations. Unfortunately, TalkNet is not really a substitute for singing or articulating words correctly. Any kind of screw-ups or noises you make in your recording have a good chance of introducing similar screw-ups into generated audio. Another thing that you want to do is avoid clipping. When you're generating audio, unless you have an absolute monster of a setup at home, it uses a significant amount of your computing resources. If you're running anything else that's GPU intensive in the background, it's going to take significantly longer. If you're running anything else that uses a lot of GPU memory, you might end up running out of memory. In terms of the auto-tune setting for generation options, I used to use this more in the past because I found that it helped a little bit with intonation, but there are some caveats with it that ultimately make it my recommendation to avoid using it. Firstly, the auto-tune setting seems to introduce some sort of volume normalization to the clip. So immediately you're starting out with a clip whose volume is not comparable to that of clips generated without the autotune setting on. In addition, sometimes if the pitch detection detects the wrong octave, the autotune setting can really screw up your vocals. Always listen to the entire clip after generation, because weird shit can happen throughout the entire clip, even at the very end. In terms of models, I try to stay away from the rarity model, given that it's based on talking data instead of singing data, which is unfortunate. Here are a few tips for fixing pronunciations. Firstly, apostrophes, contracted words, alternate spellings, or weird punctuation can all confuse the model. One thing that you'll notice in my cover of Sinking Ships, again, contracted words can be trouble spots. Sometimes in the chorus, Rainbow Dash just says V instead of U. Can't unhear syndrome. In some cases, inserting a space between two different syllables of a word, whether it be spelled out or an alphabet, can assist in pronunciation. Furthermore, in cases where the AI accidentally interprets a noise as an actual syllable, sometimes you can remedy this by adding what I call fudge syllables into your generation text. After I've got my lines generated, I do my best to edit out weird noises. I do find that TalkNet is quite good at replicating noises in my recording. I also have some general recommendations for EQ. Unlike with 15.ai, I do find that there is one piece of advice that is generally applicable to TalkNet voices. The generated voices seem to be a little heavy in the 1 to 1.5k range. In my opinion, it's best to introduce a broad cut at around 1 to 1.5k. Other things I will do are, again, introducing compression for intelligibility. Sometimes I will use a de-esser to take a little bit of the harshness out of the voices. I also find that the AI has a serious tendency to magnify any pitch errors in the original recording. I still haven't decided if it's best to pitch correct before or after the recording, but I usually do some form of pitch correction, and this can take the form of manually adjusting the pitch of clips, using some kind of autotune, whether it be with a free plugin like MAutoPitch or Auburn Grelion, or paid alternatives like WavesTune or Antara's Autotune, and of course for those of you who can afford it or acquire it through other means, Melodyne, the standard in pitch correction. Now let's go to the two dreaded command line tools, YouTube DL and FFmpeg. YouTube DL is generally the fastest way to rip audio from most websites, including YouTube and freesound.org. All you gotta do is install YouTube DL and type this command into your command prompt or terminal, and suddenly you have a WAV file of whatever you were just listening to work with. Isn't that amazing? FFmpeg is a command line utility that allows you to re-encode your audio into different formats. It actually also works on videos too, but here we're just focusing on audio. The way I like to use FFmpeg these days is I'll use my DAW to render my tracks to WAV, that is an uncompressed format that's very easy for software to read. And then I'll use FFmpeg to convert that WAV file to a lower quality MP3 for streaming, because I find that MP3 is the most widely supported music format, or FLAC for album distribution. With certain quality settings, MP3 compression isn't supposed to be noticeable, but sometimes I feel like I can feel it anyways. So for my sanity, I like to use lossless compression on the version of the tracks that ends up in the mega download for the albums. To actually use FFmpeg, all you gotta do is install it and type something like that into your command prompt or terminal. Listed on this slide is the FFmpeg command that will give you the highest quality for transcoding to MP3. And that's it. That is the end of the elements of music production. Now it is time to get into the demo. Pi Day. See you next time. We'll be right back. So this is like the second time that I've recorded this entire section, because the first attempt corrupted itself. Ain't that a hoot? Well anyways, here we are with addendum number one. This is basically a collection of a bunch of topics that I realized after recording the demo I had forgotten to cover in sufficient detail in the prior sections. And I don't have the patience to go and try to do the editing work required to shoehorn that information back into the previous sections. So here we're going to cover automation, managing computing resources, rendering and file formats, and then we're going to do a brief demo on basic effect usage. Let's get right into it with automation. Unfortunately, automation is not a way to automatically produce music. What it is a means of automating or programming the way that plugin parameters change over time. This can entail things like the ADSR settings on a synthesizer that you saw in the subtractive synthesis demo, or parameters like volume and pan. Typically, automation is done in the DAW by drawing automation curves for the plugin parameter that you want to control. However, some DAWs like FL Studio also allow you to manipulate automation through the use of clips, much in the way that you would manipulate audio or MIDI clips. In terms of why automation is done, one real obvious use case is when you're recording a voiceover, and perhaps you need your background music to be a little bit louder in some sections or quieter while you're talking. Another obvious use case is if we consider the different sections of a song, with the focus shifting from instrument part to instrument part, based on what section you're in, it may not be appropriate to use the same volume and EQ settings for the same instrument throughout the entire song. So you may want to use automation to adjust the mixing over time so that attention is focused on the right instrument. We can also use automation to create movement and interest, and we can do this by modulating more creative-oriented parameters like panning, reverb mix, or filter cutoff. Now let's talk about dealing with computing resources. The main two resources that you're going to have to deal with are RAM and CPU. Most of the pressure on your RAM is going to come from high-end, high-fidelity sampled instruments, which will make use of many heavily detailed samples. On the other hand, pressure on your CPU mainly comes from fancy synthesizers and fancy effects like delays, reverbs, or tape and amp simulators. Now you can get a vague idea of your RAM and CPU usage by looking at your task manager if you're on Windows. Some plugins, such as Native Instruments Contact, will also give you built-in displays that show you RAM usage. In addition, most DAWs will be able to give you a CPU meter or monitor that will be able to give you an estimate of how much CPU your current project is consuming. However, note that for some DAWs, the number given here is not always accurate, especially on multi-core machines. Now let's talk about ways to economize computing resources, and in particular RAM. Some high-end instruments offer light versions of those instruments, such as Native Instruments Studio Drummer Instrument. Typically, these instruments will use fewer samples than the full versions of those instruments, ultimately reducing memory usage, but at the cost of some sampling detail. Another thing that you can do is, if for some reason you need two instances of the same instrument, if that instrument is loaded in an instrument host plugin such as Contact, you can load both of those instances within Contact, and then just use MIDI channels to play the parts separately. Now there are a number of strategies that you can use to economize CPU, one of which is getting a proper hardware audio interface. But aside from that, you can also adjust your playback sample rate in your DAW, which will save you some CPU but lower the quality of your playback audio by making it more difficult for your computer to accurately represent higher frequencies. The other thing you can do is increase your buffer size. Effectively, whenever your computer plays audio, it fills a buffer that it then sends out to your sound card. The larger your buffer size, the more time your CPU has to fill out that buffer. The downside being, the larger the buffer size, the more time your CPU has to fill that buffer, also known as latency. So increasing the buffer size decreases CPU usage at the cost of latency. If we have a relatively CPU-intensive effect plugin that is used on a lot of instruments, say a fancy delay or reverb plugin, one solution that we can use is to route the sound from multiple instruments into one effect, using auxiliary sends and receives. The main drawback of this is, of course, once you've run your auxiliary send signal through that effect, there is no way to separate out the constituent instruments for individual processing afterwards. So if you do this, you're going to have to think about the order of effects that you use. Some plugins, such as VitalSynth, offer quality settings that you can alter to give you more CPU back at the expense of audio quality. In some DAWs, you can bypass or disable plugins that you aren't using in order to stop them from consuming your processing power. Keep in mind that not all DAWs prevent bypass plugins from consuming CPU. The last CPU economizing strategy that I want to talk about is rendering, also known as freezing or bouncing. The principle of this strategy is that it is easier for your computer to process uncompressed raw audio than it is for your computer to process things through plugins. We can effectively eliminate the CPU usage from a very resource-intensive instrumented effects chain by simply rendering out the sound produced by that instrument into a simple, easy-to-process audio clip, and then disabling the resource-intensive instrument and effects chain. Of course, once we've baked everything down into that audio clip, if we want to make changes to anything like the notes played or the effect settings used that were baked into that audio clip, you're gonna have to re-render the whole thing over again. And that provides us with a good segue point into rendering. If you want to turn your project into a music file that you can distribute, you're gonna have to render it. And you can render your project into many different file formats. There is a great deal of technical detail involved in discussing the different file formats, as well as a great deal of debate regarding which one is the best. I can't adequately cover all the angles of this debate, but I can give you my opinion. Generally, when you are editing audio, it is best to work with good old uncompressed WAV. It's gonna eat up a lot of file storage space, but also, working with uncompressed audio puts less of a load on your CPU, because it doesn't have to do the work of decompressing that might be involved with another format, like, for example, FLAC. FLAC uses a special kind of compression known as lossless audio compression, meaning that it can achieve the same fidelity as a WAV file, but with a smaller file size. Generally, the performance hit that you get from decompressing FLAC in real time isn't really relevant if the only thing that you're doing is listening to music. So FLAC is preferred for hi-fi playback, and FLAC is the format that I use for album distribution. Now let's get into the lossy compression formats. These are the formats where we start trading off more in quality in exchange for smaller file sizes. The famous MP3 format is probably the lowest quality of the formats that I've listed here. Generally, it will have more problems trying to reproduce high-frequency information. However, I also find that posting my files in the form of an MP3 on Smutty seems to get me the most use, and I suspect this is because people don't recognize other file formats as being sound files, which I further blame on marketers referring to music players as MP3 players for the past 2 decades. But because it's so popular, MP3 is pretty much supported everywhere. So I guess that makes it the Chad of the file formats. Now, Ogg Vorbis can achieve better quality than MP3 at lower file sizes. And Ogg Opus can achieve even higher file quality at lower file sizes. The only issue is, my DAW does not allow me to directly export to Ogg Opus, and good luck getting either of the Ogg formats to play in certain web browsers or media players. I do like Ogg Vorbis as a listening format to save space on my phone though. There are many, many other audio file formats out there, but I really don't know enough about them to say anything definitive. Last part about rendering settings, let's talk about sample rate, bit depth, and bit rate. These are all technical terms with actual meanings, but from our perspective as music producers, all we need to know is that they affect the quality of our final product. Having a higher sample rate, bit depth, and bit rate will all give us better quality at the expense of larger file size. For most consumer applications, a sampling rate of 48 kHz and a bit depth of 24 bits is adequate. When it comes to bitrate settings, the particular bitrate that is considered adequate depends on the format. My recommendations are listed on this slide. I tend to err on the side of higher quality and larger file sizes. Now let's get into the usage of basic effects. Let's start off with compression, taking a look at the Native Instruments Supercharger Compressor, which I use not just because of the meme, but because it's got this giant knob in the center that says compress. The more you turn this knob up, the more compression you get. That is, the more the loud sounds are compressed downwards. Pretty fucking simple. Now if you take a look at this output volume meter on the right, what you'll notice is that when we compress our signal down, the resulting sound is, unsurprisingly, a lot lower in volume than the sound that we started out with. So in order to bring our sound back to that original level, we gotta dial up the output. And that gets us that net effect where we make the quiet sounds louder. Now I'm going to reset these options. Now in most plugins, you're going to be able to reset these parameters to their default values just by double-clicking on them. Now let's go ahead and disable the supercharger, and I'm going to bring in a second compressor with some parameters that are more generalizable to other compressor plugins. What we see on the top left here are two important controls of a compressor, threshold and ratio. You may remember from back in the mixing section that a compressor reduces a sound when it goes above a certain threshold. This threshold knob controls exactly that. We can take a look at this gain reduction meter on the right side to see how much our sound is being compressed. Right now it's being compressed maximum around 5 decibels. But let's turn our threshold all the way down and see how that affects the gain reduction. As you can see, we're running a lot quieter. Again, if we want that original volume back, we're gonna have to rely on the makeup gain knob on the top right. Now this compressor is a bit more customizable than the supercharger compressor. We have a second knob on the left here called ratio. And what that does is control the amount of gain reduction that occurs once our sound goes above the threshold. Right now, we are at a relatively low ratio of 1.5. But if we crank that up, we're getting a lot more gain reduction. Now it's time to talk about these bottom two settings, attack and release. Attack describes how quickly the gain reduction occurs once the sound has exceeded the threshold. We can use a fast attack time to really squash down the signal. Or a very slow attack time, which will allow the first few milliseconds of each drum hit to pass through uncompressed and result in a punchier or clickier sound. Release is how quickly the gain reduction or compression decays once our sound has fallen below that threshold. Fast releases can be used to assist with punchiness, whereas slow releases can be used for more even, consistent control of dynamics. Next, let's talk about EQ. I'm going to unmute this synth sound. What I have here is a semi-parametric EQ. Essentially, it offers me a fixed collection of filters and bands whose frequencies I can adjust slightly within a certain range in order to sculpt my sound. I have low-pass filters and high-pass filters, I have low shelves which allow me to boost or cut all the frequencies below a particular frequency. As well as high shelves which do the same thing for frequencies above the high shelf frequency. As well as two mid-range peak notch bands which allow me to apply a boost or cut centered around a particular frequency. I can also use this control in the middle to adjust the width of the frequency range that is modified by the peak notch filters. A narrower peak or notch will result in a more obvious equalization effect, where you can almost hear the frequency that is being boosted or cut. Whereas a wider band will be much more subtle. Now let's talk about gating, but first let's bring in this guitar. Let's add the gate in. Recall from the mixing section that gates only allow sound in if it exceeds a certain threshold. In this case, you can see on the UI that our guitar is not actually exceeding the gate threshold level used, that is, the big moving blue square is not crossing the solid blue line, and therefore no sound is being allowed through. So we're going to have to lower the threshold. Now if we crank our attack time up, effectively what that does is it makes the gate wait before it opens. In other words, it makes the gate ignore the initial portion of a signal, kind of similar to a compressor. Let's isolate our guitar so we can hear it better. So you can use that to alter the characteristics of your sound. Hold affects how long the gate is held open after the signal falls below the threshold. And the release describes how long the gate takes to decay back down to the closed state after the input signal has fallen below threshold. Now let's bring in reverb. The main parameter to modify with reverb is reverb mix,
how much of the signal is dry, that is, the unmodified signal, and how much of it is wet, or the reverberated signal. The exact effects of the parameters that we see on the left here vary from plugin to plugin. Either the size or the decay parameter should increase the length of the reverb tail, giving the impression of being in a larger space. Pre-delay introduces a delay between the dry or original sound and the reverberated sound. Generally, a higher pre-delay setting will also give the impression of being in a larger space, as well as increase intelligibility of the dry signal. We're not going to worry about these middle parameters for now. Instead, let's move on to delays. I'm going to unmute this synth sound for us to use our delay on. Again, I'm using a Native Instruments plugin here, Replica, because it's got a simple but powerful user interface. This big knob that we see in the center controls the delay time. As we turn this down, notice that our delays get tighter around the original note. You may notice from this text down here that the delay time is actually being synchronized to the tempo of the piece, but we could always use an arbitrary time instead. The feedback setting down here describes how much the delayed signal is fed back into itself at a lower volume. If we lower feedback down to zero, we're only going to get one delay tail. This last setting down here is a bunch of stereo settings for a delay. The wide setting applies a chorused effect to the delayed signal to make it sound wider in the stereo image. Ping Pong, on the other hand, uses offset delays between the left ear and the right ear, and Normal just does the delay in mono. So that's how all that sounds together. The last thing that we're going to take a look into is a technique called sidechain compression. What sidechain compression is instead of compressing a sound based on the volume of that sound in particular, you can compress a sound based on the volume of another sound. So it allows you to squash the volume of one sound while another sound is being played. We're going to use a synth track to demonstrate this. And we're going to sidechain it to these drums. First, we need a compressor. Then we need to use the DAW's routing to set up the drums as a sidechain input into that compressor. Note that if I play right now, no sidechain compression is happening. As we can see, based on the gain reduction meter, the compression is still based on the volume of the synth. The reason for this is that we also have to configure the compressor to use the sidechain input rather than the normal input. So what you'll notice now is that our compressor is compressing based on the volume of the drums. We tweak a few settings. Let's listen to it with the sidechain compression off, and with the sidechain compression on. What you can hear is that the volume of the synth is being reduced whenever the drums play. A common technique in electronic music production is to sidechain a track, most commonly the sub-bass or pads, to the kick drum, which helps the kick drum stand out more in the mix. Alright, that's all I wanted to say about basic effects. See you next video for the demo. We'll be right back.
Welcome to the Pi Day demo, which consists of a recorded voiceover of around 10 hours of recorded footage of me putting together a song that appears on the Fractional Mirrors album that you just heard, Pi Day. Before we get started, I would like to address a few caveats about this demo that make it a little bit different from the way that I normally produce music. Number one, running OBS recording software while I am putting together music eats up my computing resources. I end up running into a lot of crashes. Some segments of the video I wasn't able to record at all. As a matter of fact, after a certain point I was using so much CPU that eventually I wasn't able to do anything at all while recording, so I had to disable recording after a certain point. The other thing that's unique about this is that this song was pretty much entirely produced over the course of one day. There are some tweaks that I made in the weeks afterwards, where I continued to try to beat the song into the shape that it is on the album. So there are a number of features of the finished product that I'm really not that happy with. Number one, I feel like the song overall is very overproduced and too sonically busy. You may also get to see that I ran into some problems with TalkNet generation that ended up affecting the quality of a final product. On the bright side, another way that you could look at this is that this demo is natty. You could think of it as representative of some of the problems that I encounter when I'm actually trying to make music. With all that said, let's get into it. During this initial segment, I've simply loaded a piano preset on one of my plugins and am using it to improvise to sort of feel out or sketch how I want the song to go. Here I use the retrospective record feature in my DAW to capture what I've just played even though I wasn't actively recording it. Essentially it works by passively recording all the time, and then I can hit this button at the bottom to commit that to the track. At this point after the improvisation, I've gotten a feel for what tempo I want, so I set it to 75 beats per minute. After this point, I started getting into some sound design, trying to design my drum kit. I wanted to go for a sound that was big and industrial, reminiscent of the sounds that I had on the Mirrorwave album. Here I start setting up routing and effects for a gated reverb effect, which I'm going to use on the snare drum. The gated reverb effect consists of applying a gate to a reverb to cut it short. It's a very common sound in 80s music that was made popular by Phil Collins. Here I have applied the reverb, and now I've applied the gate. I decided to mess around with the drum sound a little more. At this point, I just decide to record the beat for the intro. It's a bit sloppy since I really don't know what I'm trying to play, but since this is all MIDI data, I'm going to edit it later anyways. I quantize the beat to get the hits to fit the tempo, and then I start editing. Next, I decide that I want to lay out the bass, so I go digging through presets for a good bass sound. After finding my bass sound, I decide that I also want a chord sound. I eventually settled on an organ sound that I'd liked, and used it to record an organ part. And yes, I know it's clipping right now, but that's okay because it's a virtual instrument and I can adjust the volume later. Immediately afterwards, we encounter our first crash. After reloading the program, I record the organ part again, edit it a bit, and add some EQ. Then I decided that it would be neat to start the song with heavy reverb, and then create a transition effect in the intro, both by modulating the filter on the organ, using the bottom panel that you see right now, as well as starting out with heavy reverb, and then gradually ramping down the reverb mix as we progress into the intro. Here I finally decide to add a compressor and a little bit of EQ to help tame the volume levels on the organ. Next, I record and edit the beat for the verse, followed by the organ. And now the bass. I also get the idea to introduce a small two-note figure here, which I will also mirror in the organ part. At this point, I'm also going to sketch in the vocals. Now you get to hear my amazing singing voice when I don't know exactly what I'm going to sing. (Speaking in Spanish)
followed by some more editing of the organ part. And here is where I decide to mirror that two-note figure that was in the bass. I also get the idea to add some licks to the organ part. For some reason here, I decide that I need another keyboard sound. But before I figured out what I wanted to play for that second part, my computer said no, and decided to crash again. Now in this video, we're around the 12 minute mark, but I've only covered around 30 minutes of actual footage. In order to reach my target of around an hour, I'm gonna have to pick up the pace a little, and be more selective about what I'm showing you. I got the idea to add an electric piano sound, playing little plucks on the offbeat. Here I apply a bit crusher to give it some high frequency energy that'll allow it to stand out in the mix. I'm going for a kind of Frank Sinatra classic pop electronic hybrid, so it's worth adding a brass part as well. Here I write out a brass part that sort of acts as a call and response component to the vocal melody. Here I make the brass part a little thicker by doubling some notes and octaves. I like this jazzy major 9/13 voicing that I use here. Just to give myself something to play over, I copied the drum part from the previous section in order to play over it for this next section. Then I record out an idea for this second section, using an organ sound, followed by accidentally coming up with the transition to Twilight's part. Here I do some extra work on the drums, trying to get them to line up with some of the figures and the licks going on in the background. I also try to lay down a different beat for Pinky's second part. Here I decide to get rid of that keyboard sound from earlier. Here I try an interesting strategy for creating a bass line. I copy the kick drum part from previous clips and use it as a bass part, and I keep it on the same note to help build tension during this section. I flesh out this rhythmic idea by copying it into the brass. While having the pluck sound play around it. I've also made the pluck wider in the stereo field using a phaser effect. Here I decide I need some kind of a swelling pad sound. Here I use a technique called sidechain compression. Essentially, this is like normal compression, except the audio source that is used by the compressor to reduce volume is separate from the audio source that is actually being run through the compressor. Here, I sidechain compress the pad to the drums, effectively making the pad lower in volume every single time the drum plays. This is to help put the pad in the background rather than the foreground. You can't see me right now, but I'm vibing. Uh-oh, we're running out of CPU. Unfortunately, it's time to increase the buffer size. Which is bad, because that increases latency. For parts like this that I anticipate to be one-offs, I render them to audio, which helps me save some CPU that would otherwise be spent processing the plugin. I keep the plugin around and just disable it though, just in case I need to generate more sounds with it. For the second part, I decided to change the sound into a distorted organ sound with a phaser on it for a little bit of movement. I decide that we need to make the bass a little bit fatter in this part, so I layer another bass part on top of it. To make that rhythm really stand out, I duplicate it back into the kick. I work on the beat a little more, adding a drum fill for tension.
and complementing that with an extended bass note that stands out from the more sporadic bass part from before. I mock up the vocals for this section, here I really start getting interesting with the beat for this part. Then I play out a brass part, which I magically like on the first take. Something like that might work. It may seem vaguely familiar to you. I make the pluck give the brass a little bit of high-end support by duplicating the brass part into the pluck and cutting out some of the bottom notes. Next, I need to think about how I'm going to transition into Twilight section. I mock up a bass part with a rather wide range compared to the previous section. It also has natural pauses, which are places where I can add swells later. I complement the bass part with the pluck, respecting those same natural pauses, followed by the brass. While I'm thinking about flow, I go back to the previous section, removing a drum hit to create additional tension. Then I go back to what I was working on. I decide to make the beat hit a little bit harder when it comes in. And I decide to make the beat really sporadic. Respecting those natural pauses, again. I decide to add something a little cute and light within those spaces, with some synth arpeggios that aren't heavy enough to completely fill in the space. I decide to mess around with automating panning to create some movement during the second section. Here I use the reverse playback technique to create some interesting swells. I also applied some EQ to make it stand out more, and some pan automation for extra movement. Now I need to work on Twilight's Pi part, where she recites the digits of Pi over a funny sounding beat. And a bass line. And the vocals. I'm 90% sure I stole this segment from somebody, but I don't remember who. 6535897932384626264. After this initial segment, we've got to dial up the energy levels again. I really like the way I handled this sporadic pluck part here. Suddenly, I get the idea to include some kind of pitch bending in here. At first, I think I'm gonna put it on the synth plug part, but I ended up pulling out one of the plugins that I used to make the swells earlier, playing a pitch bended part, and then reversing that to create a pitch bended swell. And I do end up bringing in some more pitch bend on the organ. This bit sounded too harsh on the organ, so I moved it up to a pluck. And play this nifty little phrase on the organ at the end. We're building up again. Here I'm making sure I can still hear the bass in mono. That's one of the problems that you should be checking for. Here I grab some cymbals off my drum kit to reverse them and turn them into swells. Then I look for some funky sound effects to use as transitions. I take a rising sound effect and then reverse it to turn it into a zap. At this point, I want to start working on Twilight's rock section. So I'm going to export this portion of the track and then work on Twilight's section in a separate edit so I don't have to worry about the CPU usage from all of these plugins anymore. Before I do that though, I'm going to start with messing with the mixing on Pinky's part a little bit. I'm going to cut out the mid-lows from this brass so it interferes less with the organ, and add some mid-highs so you can still tell it's there. I personally don't think this reflects too well in the final mix, but it looked good at the time. Now let's talk about Twilight section. As soon as I had the initial idea to make this song, I also had an idea of what I wanted each section to sound like, and for Twilight's I wanted some kind of progressive garage rock, something a basic bitch like Twilight would listen to. I start out by trying to create all of my sounds. I know I want my drum kit to sound extra wide, so I use the Drummer S73 in order to provide just that. I design the drum kit, and I go through a bunch of different effects that I want to put on the drum kit. This one I think is really neat, but it's not what I was going for. In the end, I settle on some basic bitch distortion. I also create a synth bass sound to add some twanginess to the general sound of this section. Then I run it through Guitar Rig, which is a plugin that simulates a customizable array of guitar amps and effects, although in this case I'm using it on a synthesizer rather than a guitar. Then I decide it's time to set up my many guitar sounds that I use on this song. I have a very fuzzy guitar sound, an auto-filter guitar sound that I would call juicy, and a really nasal guitar sound that cuts through the mix easily. Then I start writing out the transition, having our new drums mimic the old drums from the previous section. When adding the bass part, I also added a high pass filter to help the bass stay out of the way of the other instruments at the beginning of the transition. And of course our guitars. Note that I moved this recorded part to a different effects chain, because that's a thing that you can do when you're using a digital amp simulator. What comes after this buildup? Well, it's gotta be loud and it's gotta be up-tempo. Basically, I just want a wall of sound. Now it's just all about layering instruments. Here I play a little riff. And then I double it just like you would with vocals to add extra width. Now I forgot to record the second section where this wah riff was played. A wah is a guitar effect that uses filtering to effectively make it sound like the guitar is talking. And I wanted to take this section and turn it into a verse, but I couldn't figure out how Twilight was gonna sing over it. So instead, I decide to do a key change and improvise on the bass. I end up with a weird time signature, and the prog head in me says, let's just keep that. Double the bass line into the synth part, and the guitar. Now I'm just chugging away to add a little bit more noise to the mix. And yes, I do loop this part because I didn't want to get this all done before the end of Pi Day. I start editing drums again. Drums are really important for determining the energy level of your song. Prior to this fill, I use an open hi-hat to increase energy. Now, a ridiculous amount of technical errors occurred during this recording, mostly having to do with sample rate, so the audio here isn't really salvageable. But this is the part where I record the instrumental behind Twilight actually singing, and this is also the part where I compose the singing melody. Just to really drive that progressive element home, I of course need to have a section where the time signature counts out pi, and I have a hell of a time trying to figure it out. I want this section to sound nasty, so I play what is known as the Devil's Chord, more commonly known as a tritone, on the synth. This is the most dissonant combination of two notes that you can play. And here I am trying to figure out how to play the same thing on the guitar. And here I am rubbing my pick all over the strings to make some random ass noises. Here I'm just adding a bunch of crazy noises in. This one's made using a guitar technique known as a pinch harmonic. More string rubbing. I really like this sound that I generated using the wah. So I ended up cutting it and putting it on a downbeat. Then I render out the entire thing. It's time to think about lyrics, making sure to consult plenty of online references because I don't actually know that much about baking pies. At this point, I'm just listening to the song, singing along, and trying to figure out what I can come up with.
Our favorite kind of pastry.
These are not the world's most complex lyrics.
Our favorite kind of pastry. Pop them in the oven, let them all bake.
Verse 1 is where I introduce the subject matter, and in verse 2, I decide to elaborate on the different kinds of pies. After the transition into the next section, the lyrics pretty much wrote themselves. Then of course we need Twilight to talk about pi, the mathematical concept. And let's use Vim to replace all the numbers with the words standing for those numbers, so we can feed this into TalkNet, because I'm just hardcore like that. And that is definitely not a Stack Overflow window you see in the background. Now that we have our lyrics written out, it is time to sing.
Just one bite will take you away. I'm in the oven and I'm all baked.
Doing as many takes and as many edits as I need to arrive at something that I deem acceptable to feed into TalkNet. Now for the first section, I had the idea for the melody before I knew the lyrics that I was going to sing. But for the transition after the second section, the opposite is true. I have lyrics for this part, but I don't know exactly what they're going to sound like.
Overcool, but keep an eye in.
There's another meaning to mine, but my friend Twilight can't explain that better than I.
What the fuck? Nope, that, I don't know what the fuck that was, but...
Because I can't seem to figure out how to sing this part, I end up comparing myself against a tonal instrument, in this case, an organ. Here I'm working on Twilight's part, and I decide to improvise a harmony part. The rhythm and harmony here are quite straightforward, which makes that easy to do. And of course, I have to figure out how to sing this section. It's a bit hectic, so I do some bolding in the lyrics to help me remember where to accent. And then it's time to generate. Notice how trying to upload too many files at once fails in Colab. And then we run into the big hole in this project. That is, I didn't do a mock-up at first, and we are clearly a little bit outside of Pinkie Pie's range, so now she sounds like a smoker. I end up adjusting the input pitch and then readjusting it back in the DAW to get something approximating an acceptable result. I also used my special script to generate some supporting lines for Twilight during her weird time signature section. Oh, and here's an example of the autotune functionality in TalkNet fucking something up.
Gotta learn.
I start subbing in the AI vocals, and there's a whole lot of editing that goes on. Apply some saturation to the voice here for some extra dirtiness, as well as to help it stand out better in the mix. Here I get the idea to apply a delay effect to the vocal. Here I want to make the parts said by 15.ai stand out in the mix, so I apply a bit crusher to it. Here I am trying to desperately salvage Pinkie's voice. I try out multiband compression, which I really don't understand. At this point, I had basically run out of CPU, but the basic song is down. So it looks like we're a little bit short of an hour. Always gotta keep in mind my pacing. But apparently I had misjudged how little workable content there is in the latter 4 hours of my recording. And frankly, I'm exhausted from working on this, so this is all you're gonna get. Hopefully you learned something. And that concludes the Pi Day demo.
Thanks for coming to see our show. Sad to tell you we've got to go. Grab your hat and head for the door. In case you didn't notice, there ain't any more. If you like our show, tell everyone, but if you think it stinks, keep your big mouth shut. We're glad you came, but we have to shout. Adios, au revoir, Wiedersehen, ta-ta-ta.
Goodbye!
Get lost!